just trying to change the world here, people.
Oh, really?
The Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing that you do that as an insult.
You mean true for you is different from true for anybody else?
Yeah, absolutely, because I can't
think either got to be true or not.
I can't, no.
Welcome back, citizens of Netlandia, to ORLY Radio 126, the B-side, for recorded Friday, September 16th, 2016, where we dismantle the current events for your edutainment through mostly rational conversations that make you go ORLY. I'm your host, Andy Cowen, and I still have my usual suspect, Daniel Atherton. Welcome back, sir.
Good to be back.
It was not really that long of a break, but you know what? It felt refreshing. So refreshing. So, we usually have the... audience participation and feedback in the show A, but again, I have to encourage you, if you find us in the wrong, please go ahead and stop whatever you're doing, if at all possible, and write us a note. Send it over to orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com, or of course you can send a voicemail or a text over to 470-222-6759. All right, so I believe that we're just going to get right on into it, and here we go.
If you wish to make an apple pie from scratch, you must first invent the universe.
If you're scientifically literate, the world looks very different to you. It's not just a lot of mysterious things happening. There's a lot we understand out there, and that understanding empowers you.
If you base medicine on science, you cure people. If you base the design of planes on science, they fly. If you base the design of rockets on science, they reach the moon. It works. Bitches.
That is right. So, oh man, my tea just tried to kill me. Ah! Oh. Okay. I'm better, I think.
All right. Time to go to a place where there is life, but no light.
All right. Okay. Oh, all right. Science, I need to, Yeah, back to that. Oh, my God. Ow. Okay. I'm alive. If you're still breathing and still talking, you're not actually choking to death. So you have that going for you, and I have it for me as well. Okay. Okay, so despite a complete absence of light and a poisonous atmosphere, the Romanian Movile Cave, I've probably butchered that pronunciation, but...
Movile? Yes.
Do you speak Romanian?
I have a few friends.
Then you are the subject matter expert. Congratulations. So the Romanian Movile Cave is crawling with life, quite literally, that hasn't seen sunlight for at least... 5.5 million years. That's a lot of years.
Yeah.
And they look a little bit freaky. Of course, that's a tardigrade over there, so ignore that one.
Ignore the water bear.
Yes, ignore the little water bear. So let's see here if we can get some good info as we roll through. Man, this is a horrible-looking website. Let me go to the other link. Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Okay. IFL Science has a good one. Of course, it links over to the BBC article, but the BBC is not very browser-friendly, it would seem. So, what we have here is a close-up of Cryptos anomalans centipede on the left, confronting a smaller pseudo-scorpion. Both of these species are found only in this cave. So, these are... These are creatures that have been completely cut off from the rest of the world and are living in an atmosphere that hasn't existed on the surface of the planet for a really long time. So let's see here. Otherworldly conditions is what it's being described as. It's barely humid, poisonous, cocktail of factors. fewer than 100 people have ever delved into the cave. It was only discovered in 1986 when workers of the Socialist Republic of Romania were looking for new ground to build a nuclear power plant. Nowadays, it's blocked off by the authorities and only accessible with special permissions. Although the central caverns are naturally guarded by a series of vertical shafts and narrow limestone tunnels. Once in the depths of the cave, the air contains half the amount of oxygen than usual and is high in carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide. Oh, geez, that's horrible. It is also pitch black and hasn't seen sunlight for 5.5 million years. Within the harsh environment, scientists have so far identified 48 species. Among the creatures, there's an array of spiders, water scorpions, pseudoscorpions, centipedes, leeches, and isopods, 33 of which are totally unique to this one cave.
No need for vision, and no need for pigment, because of pitch black darkness.
Yeah. They're, on the whole, a spindly bunch, with extra-long limbs and antennae that help them navigate in the darkness. Keep that same picture. Ooh. That's a new one. Okay, so this is a close-up of an armadillium. Okay. I wonder why. I guess it's basically like a blind pill bug that's only found there.
No pigment whatsoever.
Yeah, it is white. As if this world was not alien enough, it's one of the only known ecosystems that relies on chemosynthetic bacteria. Most ecosystems use photosynthesis to harness energy. However, since there's no natural light in the cave, the bacteria need to get their energy and carbon directly from chemical reactions such as oxidation of sulfide or the oxidation of ammonium. This is actually some really amazing stuff. Because this is the kind of life, you know, it's still carbon-based, but it lives in an ecosystem that is alien to what we're used to. And anytime we look at such creatures, we have to expand our understanding of where life can exist. So as we look throughout the solar system and throughout the universe, we have to keep in mind that maybe our life isn't what we're going to find. We're probably going to find bacteria, sure, but what about things like this?
Or things near volcanic vents.
Right. Which is what they're thinking might exist on... is it Titan? Titan has the... it's got a liquid ocean underneath.
Yeah. And there is some volcanic activity.
Well, but it's not volcanic.
Yeah,
it's volcanoes of water, so it's spluming liquid water into the atmosphere, outer atmosphere even. And we did some flybys, and now I may be getting it confused because there's Titan, there's Io, and Europa. Those are the big three that we're looking at in the solar system that have life, and I confuse the three terribly. So I apologize right now for that, but feel free and send an email and correct me exactly on what things are, because I know that you know out there. So let's see here. It's very likely that the bacteria have been there a lot longer than 5 million years, but that the insects became trapped there around that time. J. Colin Merle, a microbiologist from the University of East Anglia, said to BBC Earth, "They could have simply fallen in and become trapped when the limestone cast dropped, sealing the cave until it was discovered again in 86. Even after 30 years of Noen's existence, researchers still have many more inhabitants to discover, some of whom could hold massive insights into evolutionary biology and the nature of life itself." Let's see if there's anything else that we need to cover before we can move on here.
Not really, but again, this stuff is fascinating. Because, again... any closed biome gives us immense insights into how life evolves.
So there is a paper out in Science Mag about the species that have been found and about the entire ecosystem of the cave itself. So I'm gonna I'll relink that into the show notes as well, because that's some neat stuff right there. So you got plenty to look at for these show notes, which are available conveniently out on our webpage at ORLYRADIO.com for show 126B. No, it doesn't look like there's roaches, at least according to what they were saying here, Mama Van. But there are lots and lots of spiders and other things.
Arachnids.
Creepy crawlies, yeah. Arachnids seem to have done very well in this in these conditions. Though I guess centipedes and millipedes, things with lots of legs, seem to have done very well.
It has more ways of sensing what's around.
Yeah, better able to hold on to everything. So that's probably it. And there are even the life forms near the vent. Yep. Yep, definitely those extremophiles. That's a word that I needed to use. So, good stuff. Now, less extreme, but something that's definitely needed in this world, at least.
And can be revolutionary.
So, and can be quite revolutionary, would be a male birth control pill. Apparently, it's going to come. It's getting there. It might be here as early as 2018. Or maybe as late as 2020. But that's not bad. Because we've been hearing about this for a long time.
You'll have your choice of barbecue or ranch flavor.
Ah, yes, that's true. That's true. Well, I don't know. These look awfully small. At least according to what they've got here, though. This is probably a stock photo.
Yeah.
Of something. Some birth control, maybe. Yeah, that is birth control, but I don't know of which. So, this article was found out in the Telegraph. Male pill is coming. It's going to change everything. Telegraph Wonder Woman campaign. New forms of male contraception are estimated to hit the market in a few years. Unlike women's options, most won't contain hormones. Now, that's an interesting difference.
How does it work?
Vasagel is a non-hormonal male contraceptive owned by the medical research organization, the Parsimus Foundation?
Parsimus.
I'll take your word for it. It's poised as the first FDA-approved male contraceptive since the condom. What's more, it's estimated to hit the market in 2018-2020. And change the way we view contraception forever. I think that's maybe a little bit of hyperbole.
Yeah, but with Vasagel, I know Steve were here. He's one who's he's followed it for a while now in its development. But yeah, it's a removable polymer that's injected into the tubes accessible through the scrotum. So yeah, stuff stays in.
Yeah, it says it's easy. One injection would last for years.
It's also removable. You just take the polymer out, and you're fertile again.
So it's not a pill.
No, it's an injection.
It's kind of unfortunate. Kind of wished it was a pill. But also, at the same time, having such a thing, then the guy's not going to forget. You know, any of these taken internally kind of thing, they last, and then you don't have to be concerned with you know, when they necessarily run out or whether or not you're going to take it every day. So
yeah.
Okay, so as it says, Vasagel is essentially a polymer that's injected under local anesthetic into the male's sperm carrying tubes, accessible through the scrotum. Not in his penis or testicles, as some authors have erred. It works by blocking sperm and is expected to be reversible. These are words that are important. Expected to be reversible through a second injection that dissolves the polymer. Okay. We'll know for sure what length or efficacy and whether it's fully reversible after the medical trials, which begin this year in 2016. Another advantage, while it blocks sperm, other fluid can still pass through. It should reduce the risk of pain due to back pressure and occasional issue with vasectomies. This could make Vasogel a bestseller even among men seeking a permanent contraceptive option. Of course, you might well be skeptical about whether or not men will actually choose the Vasogel injection. I think there's an awful lot of them that will. I would. Probably.
Maybe. And it's not as invasive.
Mama Van, I was wondering that myself. She asks, I have to wonder how the Catholic Church is going to rule on this one.
Because they're going against it.
Because as we know, every sperm is sacred.
Yeah.
There are apparently other options, though, as the article continues. Genderusa, another non-hormonal contraceptive, has gone through phase 2 human trials in Indonesia. The method is hypothesized to work by preventing the sperm's ability to fertilize an egg. Another method is one from the U.S., is an anti-epin agent that targets sperm's ability to swim. Both of these non-hormonal methods would involve the man taking a pill. So, one way or the other, we're going to be getting male contraceptives here within 10 years. I think we're within the 10-year area. Pretty easily. I mean, we're only 2 to 4 years away from the Vasogel.
Yeah.
So these others, which are already in phase 2 clinical trials, hey, that's coming too. Which is good, because once you get one company in there doing, you know, male birth control or something, then you need to have competition in that environment too. And we know with our pharmaceutical industry, once they've got a patent, they're going to hang on to it as long as they possibly can.
Death grip.
Death grip on that money. Totally. So, yeah. I'm sure there's lots of terrible puns that I could throw in here about, you know, milking it and all that, but we'll just move along. These contraceptions are the first in line because they have support from clinical trials, but there are many others, including the clean sheets pill, designed to allow orgasm while inhibiting ejaculation. The clean sheets pill.
Yeah.
Inhibiting ejaculation. Okay. That's... I don't know what to think about that. I'm going to have to wonder about that one. It's being developed in London, and because of advances in biotechnology, researchers keep getting new ideas. The bulk of them are non-hormonal. As many women would attest, avoiding hormones would be a luxury, ensuring that contraception was worry and side effect free. Male contraception is bound to make a lot of guys happy. Being able to control the when, if, and with who you become a parent is a big deal, but you can expect their partners to smile too. Yes, I imagine so, because then, you know, it's not just a one-sided issue, obviously.
Also on top of that, again, the more and varied versions of contraception used, keeps closing and closing that error window, or error, the window of possibility.
Right, because there's nothing to say that the guy can't be on any of these and wear a condom, and there could be a female condom, and they could be on an IUD.
Or you know, one could be on the pill.
Yeah.
He can be on a pill or Vasogel.
Right.
And the use of a condom. Oh, look, you are that 1% or 3% or...
Yeah, the 97% effective or whatever, yeah.
All of a sudden, you're closing that percentage window.
Mm-hmm.
So you're being responsible, you're being safe.
Yeah.
And that's the way to do it.
So then, if truly both partners have been that safe and you still get pregnant, then you can go ahead and claim your miracle. You can say that they're your little miracle and everything will be fine. Or you can go to Planned Parenthood. So, moving right along from that, I think we can safely tuck that one back in our pants. Now, the White House and NASA have discussed asteroid redirect missions.
Oh, they were?
Yeah. Now, this would be the kind of thing that I wish that David was here for, because he's, of course, you know, one of our bylines for the show is we got to get off this rock. And one of the reasons that we need to get off this rock is so that we are planet independent, so that we can be on a multi-planet species. So in this case, it's planetary defense. In addition to all the things that we would learn for journeys to Mars and, well, just everything else that we learn when we do space travel. So as part of the asteroid redirect mission, reading from the article, NASA plans to send a robotic spacecraft to an asteroid tens of millions of miles away from Earth, capture a multi-ton boulder, and bring it to an orbit near the moon for future crew exploration. The mission, which will demonstrate multiple capabilities needed for the journey to Mars, is targeted for launch in December 2021.
Cool.
This is neat. Now, there's a bunch of companies out there that are working on asteroid mining. So now that NASA's getting involved with that, there's going to be some cross-pollination with those companies that are interested in doing that.
The important place of government is putting down infrastructure when private industry doesn't have money for the investment.
Right. So this
will help develop technologies that will allow for asteroid mining.
Of course, the problem with all of these space resources as we have them is that small problem of gravity. Getting out of our own gravity well and then making it, you know, the other is the big thing of just the distance involved. These things take time. So you would want it to be a robotic mission to then bring it back to where people aren't having to spend all that time back and forth, because keeping a person alive in space is an expensive endeavor.
And chancy.
Well, that's part of the expense, because if you follow the NASA thing, then everything has to have like triple redundancy easily. So everything is more expensive. Even before you get into the real safety features, everything is more expensive.
No, you want to invest in better robotics, better AI.
But these are all things that are starting to be invested in private industry. But what this does is allow for groundwork to be made towards new technologies for asteroid capture and movement. Things that are still very, very new.
Now, some of the word choice that they're doing is, it's reflective of the real goal here. Industry is being noted. Community being noted. So these are things where we want to create an entire industry out of dealing with asteroids. So it might be a matter of, you know, that one's kind of dangerous. How about we move it? And if we're going to move it, how about we go ahead and cut it up for use? I think that'd be awesome.
Especially with some of the rare earth elements. I mean, neodymium magnets, we don't have an infinite supply of those.
That's true. And we definitely need them for a lot of current things other than just toys.
Yeah. No,
it's
there's
like,
a lot
of... Do I have
any
on my desk? No, I don't have any on my desk right now.
But there's a lot of resources that, again, if you want to keep this rock in a decent state, or redirect it into a positive state, being able to go out of Atmo, harvest those resources with making less of a carbon footprint, destroying and less of our environment, and bringing all those delicious, delicious resources back to our rock.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because bringing them into atmosphere... A lot easier than getting them out of atmosphere. Because gravity is then on your side. Then you just have to direct it the right way.
Yeah, you direct it to the most appropriate splash zone.
But more importantly, if you already have those resources in space, then you have an industry base for zero-G manufacturing or low-G manufacturing or, of course, drop it on the moon and build it there. You know, because we need a little bit of gravity for our own biology's sake. But for manufacturing, some things would do really well to be manufactured in very low microgravity environments.
Well, also, temperature control becomes a different conundrum.
Well, you've got other issues with radiation, the heavy radiation, heavy temperature controls, vacillating between, you know, hundreds degree, near zero kind of environments to much higher. It's hot. It's cold. It's hot. It's cold. It's hot. It's cold. Are you facing the sun? No. So if you're not facing the sun, well, then you're in a shadow of something, and then it's super cold. So most of our energy in those cases is just temperature regulation. So there's a lot to consider, and it's not super safe to have people in these environments. You know, we do have a pretty darn good International Space Station set up. And, you know, this segues neatly into NASA's desire to sell the ISS.
Yes, it would.
So, of course, it's the International Space Station, so NASA would only be selling their controlling interest. It would be up to the other nations to do the same.
I could definitely see Russia, with the current climate, wanting to, you know, sell theirs to a wealthy oligarch.
Well, it would have to either be a wealthy oligarch, or they would then say, no, that is ours. We're not going to let it go. You know, because they've been the one ferrying people up
for
so long.
Or they buy our interest.
That is a possibility, too. Yeah, they could definitely try that. We probably wouldn't be opposed to that.
No.
Well, financially, we wouldn't be opposed to that. Intergovernmentally, we would be opposed to that.
Depends on who's at the head of our government.
Well, at that point, then we're just giving the crown of space to what has been historically our biggest competition.
Yeah, but most of our politicians aren't interested in space as they used to be.
Well, they still are, though.
Some are.
I mean, we have the Space Launch System, which they're trying to build stupidly large, because they have some delusions of grandeur, and then there's SpaceX, of course, which they've continued to fund and finance and pour resources into. And this is mostly to then get another manned spacecraft that can launch from United States-controlled space, as opposed to being reliant on frickin' Soyuz capsules. You know, we're using them as a taxi service. You know, that's, to a lot of the people on Capitol Hill, that's degrading. To have to rely on them to get us up there to do our thing. We don't want to do that. So, as long as that's on their minds, and I think that everyone should definitely call your representatives and, you know, make sure that it is on their minds. You know, penny for NASA. Give them a little money. It's going to be one of those issues. It may not be an issue that's stated really loud, but there is always going to be that pride. There's a lot of pride in space for all the things that we've accomplished. And it could be a leverage point. I think it should be a leverage point. We can use that. Space industry already delivers so much more money than is put into it, you know, to all areas of industry. So
pretty much for every penny we get $10 back.
Yeah, it's huge. It's a huge return on investment. I don't know if it's that far, but it's good. Yeah, maybe for every dollar.
No, it was that far during the 60s and 70s.
Right, but that was also, we also poured money in, I don't actually know that that is the case, because we put so much money into the 60s that they were blank checks. I mean, the space industry at that point did not exist. It was an entire startup. It was a war machine put to get somebody to land on the moon. We were not going there for research purposes.
No.
It was a capture the flag mission. So it was an entire war machine put behind it to make it happen. Fortunately, they never completely gave up on it, and we ended up with a NASA that then had all those resources that were poured into it that could carry on, you know, and sneak some really good science in there. And of course, we, you know, given that they had the blank checks, a lot of things were learned because of, you know, rapid iteration and failure rates. So we got an awful lot out of it. But I think that at that time period, trying to figure out how much money we actually poured into what then became NASA would be difficult to figure out. You know, trillions, probably, over the course of many, many years. I mean, they poured billions in. Oh, yeah, it's a great investment, and it is something that is continuing to pay off. And now the budgetary concerns, you know, now that they've got all that infrastructure in place, now it's definitely a major return that every dollar that goes into their budget, you know, at least comes out 10, maybe 15 fold pretty easily in just ancillary things that come out. You know, we've talked about all the patents and the papers and the research that they've now just open sourced to everyone.
Yeah.
You know, trying to figure out now how much money is really, can be extrapolated out. It's tough because we don't know what those knockdown effects, you know, when did it go back? It's almost like 6 degrees of separation for NASA. Just, you know, it's NASA instead of Kevin Bacon.
Yeah. But like things like Velcro.
Yeah. Velcro is always a good favorite. The space, the vacuum space pens, you know, things like that. You know, yeah, we had to put some money behind things like that.
But also, stuff like vacuum packaging for food.
Mm-hmm. Dehydration. Freeze drying. Yeah, dehydration, freeze drying. You know, massive things that have now revolutionized our entire food industry.
Vacuum technologies.
Yeah. Huge things. Radiation shielding. Lots of shielding, telecommunication industry as a whole, you know. Yeah, I mean, it's amazing stuff that has come out of it, and we could go on for several shows just talking about that. But how this is going to affect us in the near term, it's not. But in the long term, in, you know, tens, twenties of years, we're definitely going to see companies, not even governments, but companies that are farming the asteroid belt for resources. And what they do with those resources will be very interesting. Because I'm pretty sure that no government on the planet is going to want them to just randomly toss an asteroid down so that they could then come back and pick it up and use what's left. So they're going to have to do a lot of whatever material extraction is going to have to be done in space.
Yeah.
So,
but there's stuff.
It's going to get busy. Rich. It's going to get busy up there.
Iron rich, nickel rich. Oh,
yeah. Yeah. Heavy.
Stuff that we really use.
Yeah. And if you are able to bore into them enough, you can create habitats inside. Yeah. And there's some big ones out there. You could fit a pretty decent mining colony or something inside them. Provide just enough rotation to give yourself a nice spin.
Give yourself some gravity.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you've got an off-world habitat. So, okay. So this is going to be interesting. They are definitely focusing on the industry options here. I don't think they really want that much to do with it, but they might be using it as a as a crutch to get other people interested and investing in it wholeheartedly.
Again, put in the investment through the government, through NASA, to start developing infrastructure. That's what NASA's great at.
Yeah.
Have them develop the infrastructure and then let private interests take over.
That's really what the what the whole government is good for, is infrastructure.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's typically
private industry doesn't have the capital.
Right. Not as a whole. I mean, if they teamed up, then they would, but that team up is called taxes, so then they are, and it's government.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just all depends on how you look at it. On to Law and Order. So, you know those guys, those crazy cats up in Oregon?
Yeah.
Those crazy cats up there. They took over a bird sanctuary for no real good reason other than cattle rights and some interesting publicity. It was the Bundys, Ammon Bundy and his brother Ryan and five other supporters. They were accused of conspiring to intimidate federal employees on the but the occupiers say it was a peaceful protest against government overreach.
It was an armed protest.
It was an armed protest at a wildlife refuge. So, very strange.
They got a 55-gallon drum loop.
Yes, they did. Yes, they did. Man, God, the comedy was just so good. So good. They were sent bags of dicks. They were sent lube. It was just amazing. But anywho, that happened in January. But now the actual trial of these yahoos has now gotten underway Tuesday in a federal courtroom. In opening statements, defendants and their attorneys argued the standoff at the Mellor National Wildlife Refuge was a peaceful protest against government overreach of public lands and the prosecution of a local ranching family. But a federal prosecutor told jurors the case was not about the defending protests of or beliefs, but their intimidation and threatening of federal employees. Yeah, because you took over a federal building. You stole federal vehicles. You went joyriding in them. You were all armed on federal property. It's
and
crazy.
You were aiming firearms at federal employees.
They damaged security devices. They caused a lot of, you know, actual property damage. So, quote, "We are not prosecuting the defendants because we don't like what they think or said. We are prosecuting them because of what they did." Good. Because they aren't really going to have much of a defense against that. No. Outside the courtroom, protesters gathered at the Portland Federal Courthouse, where supporters of the defendants referred to the men as political prisoners.
If you look at the clothes of the protesters, I would like the audience to note just how painfully white those protesters are. I don't think there's a single minority amongst them.
No. No. And we were mentioning that when they were camped out, having to go for snacks because they didn't actually pack very well.
Yeah.
These aren't the brightest bulbs.
Mom, please send beer money.
Yeah, it was terrible. And send donations so that we can keep this going. It's like, what are you thinking you could do? It was so strange. And there were people that said, I want to go and I want to protest the federal government, but I can't because my welfare check isn't here yet. Mm-hmm. Do you see what you just did there? Because we see what you just did there. You're living off the federal government, and now you're going to go protest where your food is coming from. The cognitive dissonance is great with this group and their supporters. Anywho, among the group facing federal charges is standoff leader Ammon Bundy and his brother Ryan, the sons of Cliven Bundy, who had also sparked a wonderful standoff where there were sniper rifles actually trained on government agents. And yet, none of them were taken into custody. No, none of them were arrested.
None of them were shot.
None of them were shot. It was peacefully De-escalated.
Yeah. It was de-escalated because they were white.
Yes. Clive and Bundy was charged in connection to the Nevada standoff earlier this year after local and federal officials took action against the Oregon occupiers and arrested his sons. So maybe they're still going after him? I don't know. Weird with the federal statute of limitations on threatening the government. most of the occupiers left the refuge on January 26 when the state and federal officials launched an operation to arrest the leaders of the group as they tried to pull over two vehicles carrying leaders in the occupation. One of the drivers fled and crashed into a snow embankment as he came upon a roadblock. It was a lot of fun covering this. It was week after week after week of, why are they still there? Why are they still there? It doesn't make any sense. It was a lot of fun, though. So let's see. Oh, nice. What is it said about people that represent themselves?
They have a fool for a client.
Well, Ammon Bundy's brother Ryan has chosen to act as his own attorney.
Oh, dear.
It's right there. Yeah.
Well, that's somewhat of a strategy, because then he can appeal the more than likely guilty verdict because of poor representation, that being himself.
Yeah, I suppose.
No, it is a valid strategy and try and get a less, because it's been used before, to try and on appeal get somebody who's less interested in the case as a prosecutor and actually then pony up the money to get a good appeals attorney to try and go back through your previous case for any screw up on the prosecution side.
Yeah, I don't know, though, that he's doing this in that way.
I'm just pointing out the possibility of him having a brain.
It is a possibility. He said also, I felt we were not there to break the law, but to enforce the law. I am very in favor of government as long as it's done correctly.
So you're in favor of breaking into government property, threatening government officials, destroying public property. Oh, good grief.
Yeah. Barrow argued that the Bundys and supporters conspired not only to take over the federal refuge, but to threaten and intimidate local and federal officials in the area, which they pretty much did on camera for the entire world to see. A total of 26 people were charged in the 41-day standoff, a whole month plus.
Plus.
All but seven agreed to sign plea deals. Fun.
Yeah.
So
which
much
means
fun.
Most of those guys that are out will be testifying against those who didn't.
Yeah, that's true.
That's a lot of people to use as character witnesses against those who didn't plea out.
Absolutely. I can't wait. It's going to be so wonderful. Okay. Now, this came up, and it brought to my attention a couple of things. Now, conservative Republican Congressman Jim Bridenstine, from
it's
Oklahoma.
Not Bridenstine?
I'm going to say Stein.
Okay.
I don't know why. I went with that.
I want a young Frankenstein joke.
Yeah, I know. But I don't want to waste it on him. He's very conservative. A very conservative Republican. However, he has issued and backed two bills that are really good.
Oh.
These are really good things. The first one is the, well, I guess the first one is actually the Read the Bill Act. But they work in tandem.
Okay.
You know, he's working on this together here. The other is the One Subject at a Time Act. So, yeah, this is some interesting stuff. So, okay. Guys, get your government propeller hats ready, because this.
Let's dive in.
We're going to dive in a little bit. We're, you know, not too much, because, well, there's honestly, these are fairly short. But the Read the Bill Act for this Congress here, the summary of the text, it was introduced in January, so, you know, it's out there. This bill prohibits consideration of any bill or resolution in the House of Representatives or the Senate unless its text is published on an official website of the Clerk of the House of the Secretary of the Senate at least the applicable minimum number of hours, excluding those in which the chamber is not in session, before consideration of the bill or resolution, namely 72 hours for text of 300 or fewer pages. For text more than 300 pages, the sum of 72 hours plus 24 hours for each additional increment of 100 or fewer pages. So you get a day, basically, for every 100 pages of text in a bill that you'd have to go through. That's the amount of time that it sits in wait. Whenever the House or Senate committee reports a bill or joint resolution proposing to repeal or amend all or part of a statute, it must include in its report or in an accompanying document the following: the entire text of each section of the statute proposed to be repealed or amended, a comparative print of each amendment to the section of the statute that the bill or joint resolution proposes to make. So basically, show us what you're actually changing.
Yeah.
In what you're proposing.
I like this, because one of the things that covered in college was we actually, in global perspective, we had to cover the Patriot Act, that bill.
Oh my God.
that was our final, essentially.
Wow.
Sitting down and reading through that, what the Patriot Act did a lot of was change just a few words in a load of bills. It changed a lot of ands into ors.
Interesting.
That was a significant amount of the changes, was just a few words here, a few words there, amending previous bills. And those bills, whilst cited and the line, we did not get an example in the write-up for the Patriot Act
of what got changed.
So you would have to go back to those bills and read how the language was being changed. That's why that's part of the reason why it got passed so quickly, is no one actually did the homework.
Yeah, that, and of course everyone was still terrified of terrorists and everything. So
yeah, but yeah. Part of the problem a lot of times with Congress is that it's not the congressman who's reading the bill. It's their staffers.
Right.
And the staffers are overworked, underpaid.
If paid at all.
Paid. And they essentially do if they've got the time, give them a summary of the bill, and it's on their summary that they base their vote.
Mm-hmm. Get this. Neither chamber nor Congress jointly may dispense with or otherwise waive or modify the requirements of this act. This is a mandate.
Whew.
This is a 3-day waiting period. This is a cooling off period for a bill.
I like it. I like it a lot.
Yeah. Any act of Congress that was considered as a bill or resolution in the House or Senate in violation of this act shall have no force or effect, and no legal, equitable, regulatory, civil, or criminal action may be brought under it.
It's thorough.
It's simple.
Simple and thorough. That's amazing.
It's following its own rules. So it's like, this is amazing. And it's being brought by a Republican.
This is law I can get behind.
This guy, he introduced it. So, it's amazing. I mean, it's not really that long. Look.
No. It's a page or a page and a half.
Yeah, we're reading the summary, but yeah.
The actual bill itself is about page and a half.
We'll give it two. We'll give it two pages, but yeah. That's all.
A two-page bill, that's practically unheard of.
Mm-hmm. It's introduced, and that's it. Nothing else has really happened, it looks like.
It hasn't moved through the bureaucracy.
Oh, wait, it was, at the time that it was introduced, it was then referred to the House Committee on Rules, where it will sit and languish probably for all time.
Yeah.
Because that is pretty much where things go to die.
It dies in committee.
Yeah. So, that was awesome. But then, he is at least supporting another one, which is the One Subject at a Time Act. Are you noting a trend here?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's trying to simplify government in a big way. Note the summary length of this one.
A page.
No, it's less. It's not even a page. Okay.
I'm being generous.
Yeah, you're being generous. Now, this one came out the same time. These came out together. Again, January 6th, 2016. One subject at a time. The bill requires, one, each bill or joint resolution to embrace no more than one subject. And two, the subject to be clearly and descriptively expressed in the measure's title. The bill prohibits an appropriations bill from containing any general legislation or change of existing law requirement if its subject is not germane to the subject of such bill. Wow.
No, it gets more thorough.
Wow. The bill also declares void, one, an entire act or joint resolution if its title addresses two or more unrelated subjects. Two, provisions in legislation not clearly and descriptively expressed in the measure's title. Three, appropriation provisions in legislation outside the relevant subcommittee's jurisdiction. And four, provisions of appropriation bills not germane to their subject matter. Aggrieved persons and members of Congress shall have the right to bring an action against the United States to seek appropriate relief, including an injunction against the enforcement of any law the passage of which did not conform to this act. That may kill it right there.
Yeah.
You know, and similarly with the other one, that last line of how they want to enforce it retroactively to everything, that's going to be a problem.
Well, there's also another problem with this ever being passed in American politics.
Yeah, they won't be able to put in all their fluff for everything.
You know, pork and compromise.
Yeah.
American politics is built upon the principles of pork and compromise.
Yeah.
And that's why you have bills that are about, you know, gun control containing appropriations for, you know, building bridges.
As well as something to defund Planned Parenthood.
Yeah.
And or a veterans bill that also defunds Planned Parenthood or something. And that's why people didn't vote for it. And then all of a sudden they're against veterans.
Yeah. No, that is the nasty truth of how our politics is done. Because you can kill a bill by adding stuff to it. You can also, again, how you get a bill passed is adding pork to make people compromise.
Right.
That's how bills get passed. This makes it so that can never happen.
Right.
Unless the appropriations are in accordance to the subject of the bill.
Yep.
So if this is a bill on gun control, hi, you can actually make an appropriations rider for your state to get funding for gun control. That's it.
Yeah. Imagine how much easier all of our legislation would be had this been introduced in the in 1800.
Well,
just imagine.
There's a number of problems with that.
We'd be missing a lot of black helicopter ops and things like that. But you know,
no, there's two problems with this. One with back then, one with getting past now. Mm-hmm. Back then, again, you had people who were government. There was a culture that compromise was not a filthy word,
right?
And it's how the process gets done. And you had this principle that a number of my friends like to refer to as statesman.
Sure.
As a statesman, you are trying to govern in interest and fidelity to your constituents. You are trying to do what is in their best interest.
Mm-hmm. Do the job in the spirit of the job?
It's less the letter and more the spirit.
Yeah.
That's not how it is in this day and age. So back then, this wasn't necessary because the job wasn't abused the way it is today.
It wasn't a career.
No. This is something that you did there were a few people who actually made it careers, but for the most part, it is something that you did for part of your life. And then you went back to your regular life.
Yeah. Back to the farm, back to the legal office, you know, any number of things that you did before. There's countless examples of where that happened.
Yeah, but
I'm not sure exactly when things got, when they went all kind of pear-shaped and we ended up with career politicians.
Well, he had them even early. It's just they were in the minority.
Yeah.
We've always had them.
And they weren't loud about it.
No. But they were in the minority. It was actually when we got to around the time of the Civil War that you saw the rise of the career politician and it being something just integral to American politics. And since then, it is the concept of being a politician has gone farther and farther from the original intent. And that's part of the reason why this bill won't get passed, because it eats into the bread and butter of the lobbyist and therefore the politician.
Yeah. Look at how many people sponsored it, though.
Still won't pass.
No, it won't. You know, it's almost irrelevant. But Mrs. Love, Mr. Mulvaney, Mr. Stewart, Mr. Massey, Mr. Ratcliffe, Mr. Jordan, Mr. Pierce, Mr. Walker, Mr. Brett, Mr. Labrador, Mr. Blum, and Mr. Yoder. And then, of course, the other guy that we were talking about earlier.
He who sponsored the bill.
Yeah.
But, no, this... Both of these are great. I just don't see them ever being applied to American politics because that's not how it's done. I hate saying that phrase.
Yeah, it changes the politics is what it does.
Yeah. It makes it so that you are forced to govern. You're not forced to play politics.
Okay, so it was immediately it was referred to the House Committee on the Judiciary.
Yep.
And then a month later, it was referred to the Subcommittee on the Constitution and Civil Justice, seeing about the constitutionality of it. Interesting.
Because the retroactive clauses.
Right.
Right. That.
That's going to kill it.
I mean, that's going to kill it.
Yeah.
Now, it can be amended to where that's taken out.
Yeah, I think... Why, I don't know why they didn't do it. Why not just say, well, I know what they were doing. They were trying to get rid of Obamacare. But with because of how many pages it was, you know, not being able to possibly go through it all. And they didn't like it. But I think if they remove the retroactive thing, and said that anything going forward has to go with these. That would make everyone's life easier.
Everyone but the politician.
Right. Actually, it would probably even help the politicians, especially the one with the Read the Bill Act. I love that one.
I would, of the two, that's the one I would prefer to actually move forward, because it also has a secondary effect in that those bills that are not considered classified are up on a public forum to be seen and discussed for a long enough period for the press and private citizenry to understand the bill.
But this line right here, under enforcement, a member of Congress, this is the Read the Bill Act. A member of Congress aggrieved by the consideration of a bill or resolution in violation of such applicable requirements by the House of Congress in which the member serves. So, again, that's back to we don't like Obamacare because it was too big and we can complain about it because it was too big to read. So they can go back and say, you know, we didn't like this because of this and try to file a legal action against it because of this.
Yeah. No, but the thing is, you go down that route, you have plenty of things that were passed that are like Republican tax cuts or the fact that you can't, you know, research gun deaths and you can aggrieve those, and it turns into this giant legal fight. But
yeah, I like the spirit of this.
Yeah. I don't like the intent.
Yeah, because I mean, this the enforcement section here. You know, just to go through it, it is clearly a gun to be brought to the head of a bill that they didn't like, that was passed already in the past.
Yeah,
that's very much what this is. So, but really, they could just say, okay, fine. You've had time to read it now. Let's take it for another vote. So, yeah, they're going to have to be careful with that because everyone there is a lawyer anyway.
No, but it would be interesting to actually, instead of seeing these bills passed at the federal level, which I think is an impossibility.
Yeah.
But getting somebody to come up with something similar, but without the retroactive clauses, pass at state government level.
Ooh, that's a good idea. Get them down to the state level.
Yeah. It would streamline things a great deal.
Yeah.
It would cut a lot of corruption out.
It would.
And it would make it so that bills passed in a far quicker manner. It would die faster or it would pass faster.
It would streamline government like crazy.
It would be a good thing.
Yeah. There would be more bills. Because more things would have to be entered in separately.
But you know what? That means that more law gets written as law as opposed to a get-rich-quick scheme.
Yeah. Yeah, it would also be harder to... There'd be less loopholes.
Yeah.
Or at least potentially less loopholes. It'd certainly be easier for IBM's Watson to act as that legal exec and look through the law and figure out whether or not it was wrong or anything like that. Because it's like, this is this. Okay, that's easy for a computer to do.
Yeah.
Okay, so that was Law and Order with a little bit of congressional law. So I hope that you enjoyed that. I know I did.
Hi, ORLY Radio listeners. This is your host, Andy Cowen, calling my voicemail to make sure that it still works. Please consider calling us, 470-222-6759. Bye.
It's time for another good idea, bad idea. Good idea.
Ha 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 ha. You thought I was done with government, didn't you? You're wrong.
Yeah, but right now we're enjoying delicious steak.
That's right. I just pulled that right out from under you. Yep. So the House has passed a bill outlawing gag clauses that try to punish customers for writing negative reviews. Now, of course, it's more than that. That's the headline. But it very neatly, you know, boiled it down to kind of like, here's the intent of what this is. In legalese, you do have to kind of do a little bit of translation back to English, common speak. So this afternoon, by a simple voice vote, with no apparent objections, the House passed the Consumer Review Fairness Act, a bipartisan piece of legislation, however that happened, that would void any existing non-disparagement clauses in consumer contracts and give the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, and State Attorney General the authority to take enforcement action against businesses that attempt to use non-disparagement clauses to quiet customers.
How I feel this got passed is because there is, I should say, old guard Republicans that are for this law, and them standing up with Democrats to get this passed. New guard or alt-right would hate this thing with a passion.
Yeah.
But because, I mean,
free speech, just, free speech, free speech.
Yeah. No. But specifically, this gives the state's attorneys generals, so states' rights.
Yeah.
Which is a thing they love to tout.
With the backing of the Federal Trade Commission.
Yeah. Which, again, that's old guard Republican.
Mm-hmm.
Old guard Republican, this smells to high heaven of it. But again, they had some things right, and this is one of them.
Yeah, you know, actually, that's the thing. What we've actually done here in the last three bills that we've looked at, we agree with what the Republicans are doing in this.
Yeah,
for the most part. Again, you know, we see why they were doing it, but yeah, for the most part, it's like, hey, you guys got some good ideas. We like that.
It's letter versus spirit versus intent.
Yeah.
Because the intent with the previous two was not in keeping with the letter or the spirit.
Yeah. Because it very clearly had one spirit to it.
Yeah.
And very clearly in the execution of it, it was a hammer for a nail. A very specific nail.
The intent.
Mm-hmm.
Was different than the spirit.
Yeah.
Because that's how it is with government. It's three separate faces.
Yeah.
So what's the intent behind this thing? What's the dark cloud we can suss out of this?
Well, that's a good question, because I found this out on the Consumerist. Consumerist.com. So let's see. In late 2015, the Senate unanimously passed its version of the bill, the Consumer Review Freedom Act. So apparently this has just been something that's been in the pipeline for a while. This is in response to crazy things like the Texas pet sitter that sued a customer for $1 million over a negative Yelp review.
Hey, I feel a little tinfoil in my head.
Go ahead.
Charge
up the capacitors. Go ahead.
Actually, this may be and why this is getting through now is in preparation if Trump wins. Because this would already be on the books.
Okay. So,
remember, Trump wants to open up libel law like you wouldn't believe. That's one of the things he's campaigning for. This keeps that from happening at the corporate level.
This
is to guard against Trumpism. They're pushing this thing through.
Interesting. That's interesting. The Republicans that are scared to death.
The Republicans are going, this is who my party nominated.
Oh, we got to do something.
Good gods, no.
We got to do something about that. That's not going to work at all.
Well, I mean, yeah. Laura Bush just came out with Michelle Obama and our didn't, in heavy quotation marks, criticize Trump. But again, those two first ladies on the same stage, if you said that they would be agreeing on anything, I would have called you a liar 2 years ago.
I would have said, what was it, a salad or a covered dish? I could see them maybe agreeing on that. But wow.
No, again, it's like those two are actually backing Hillary, and I'm like, holy cow, what world have I phased into?
Apparently, the case that brought this issue into the spotlight involved a failed attempt by an online retailer, Clear Gear, to hit a customer with a $3,500 penalty after she wrote a truthful but negative review of the company online. There were also cell phone accessory sellers who would fine you $250 for even mentioning you'd say something negative. The wedding contractors who made newlyweds agree not to encourage negative feedback, and the apartment complex that claimed to hold the copyright on all the tenants' reviews and photos of the property. Yeah, what? This was bad. This was really bad. I remember all these coming through. In 2014, California banned the use of these clauses, but a subsequent nationwide legislation effort stalled on Capitol Hill. So then it was in 2015. Congressman Leonard Nance out of New Jersey and Representative Joe Kennedy, Massachusetts, took up the cause in the House this spring with the Fairness Act. Though the bill garnered significant bipartisan support, it still took quite some time to, getting through the House to get a floor vote. With today's passing, the House version goes back to the Senate for reconciliation. Given the near-identical text, that should not take long. At some point, it would finally go to the president for signing into law. I'm not seeing any gotchas.
Yet.
Yeah. Let me see. So this is the... What is the name? So that was the consumer... Well, I guess we can look at the Consumer Review Freedom Act, since they say that the text is nearly identical. Oh, wait, there's a link? No, there's no link there. Why did it try to give me a link? Search Google. Okay. Let's see. Ah, there it is. Okay, Consumer Review Freedom Act of 2015.
One amendment.
Let's see the summary of the text. Okay, so bill makes provision of a form contract void from the inception. It prohibits or restricts an individual who is party to such a contract from emerging in written, oral, pictorial reviews or other similar performance assessments or analysis of, including by electronic means, the goods, services, or conduct of a person that is also a party to the contract, the review, basically, imposes penalties or fees against individuals who engage in such communications, transfers or requires the individual to transfer intellectual property rights in review or feedback content. Yeah, so these are actually addressing those cases, like, nope, 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 we're not going to have any of that. Liking it so far. Standards under which provisions of a form of contract are considered void under this act shall be construed to affect. Okay. Legal duties of confidentiality, civil actions for defamation, libel, or slander, a party's right to establish terms and conditions for the creation of photographs or videos, such as parties' property when these photographs or videos are created by an employee independent contractor of a commercial entity and are solely intended to be used for commercial purposes by that entity. I think I'd probably have to read that like four more times to actually get the real gist of that sentence. Such standards shall also not be construed to affect any party's right to remove or refuse to display publicly on an internet website or web page owned, operated, or controlled by such party content that A, or one, contains the personal information or... so this is no doxing.
Yeah.
No doxing people at all. No harassment, no abusive, obscene, vulgar, sexually explicit, inappropriate with respect to race, gender, sexuality, ethnicity, or other intrinsic characteristics. Boy, they really got it all right there. And two, is unrelated to the goods and services offered by... So basically, you can't bait and switch it. You know, you can't say that it's about one thing and then completely attack them in another area.
Yeah.
It has to be related to the review.
It's actually defamation or libel where it's false.
Or is clearly false or misleading. Clearly. That's in here. Okay.
Enforcement is provided by the FTC and states.
Yeah. Do you see any gotchas? I mean, it seems
not
pretty
directly.
It seems pretty clean.
Yeah, not directly.
A person is prohibited from offering form contracts containing a provision that is considered void under this act. So don't bother, you know, if you do any of this, A, it's against the law, and B, it will not be valid.
It invalidates the contract.
Yeah.
So be careful, especially all you property owners that want to, you know, screw your tenants.
They kind of nerf it here on the last sentence, though. The FTC must provide business with non-binding best practices for compliance. So basically, they can say, here's how we'd like to see you do it, but you don't have to do it that way, but you do still have to follow the law, of course.
Yeah.
So it might be interesting. So... yeah, of course the text is much longer, but mostly it's formatting.
And it's format and slightly deeper legalese.
Yeah, the summary was decent. Effective dates, relation to... Yeah, it could be... There might be something in here, but I don't see any weird things, which is odd lately. Usually those things are just jumping right. It's like, oh, I see what you're trying to do with that. So, Mama Van says, does that mean I have to withdraw my remark about Ryan Bundy? No, you can leave it here. Because you're not in a contractual relationship with him. So, this would be in regards to, if you were somehow, like, doing an Airbnb of, like, his ranch or something, and then... You said something about him, like, hey, the property was great, but the guy was fat, or, you know, some other defamation. Then you'd get in trouble for the defamation, possibly. But if he then tried to fine you for something under that, if it was clearly wrong, then he'd be in the wrong, you know. So there would be recourse there in that kind of arrangement. Now, this would be federal law, so that would still have to be a state thing, which would why the FTC and state lawmakers would be involved. So, yeah, in many cases, this isn't going to matter. You know, yeah, it's against the law, and a good legal stationery with the appropriate magic words on it should take care of it. But if you actually had to bring it to suit, you're going to spend an awful lot more money than you're ever going to recoup out of this kind of thing. So if you do, it's going to be very much you're standing up for what you believe in, for what's right kind of thing, if you take it to court. You know, and if you follow all this, and thankfully it's not that long, but if you follow this, it'll be fine. you'll be okay. So, interesting stuff. Very interesting. Mm-hmm. So that was a good thing. Gag clauses are horrible and clearly against free speech in general, especially correct free speech. If you're expressing a correct opinion on something and somebody doesn't like the fact that you're correct, and then they try to have punitive measures against you for saying something like that, then yeah, they should not be allowed to do that, and that's what this law does. So, oh my gosh, good job, government. I never get to say that. So yeah, that's why it's in the good ideas. So moving right along, let's talk about Planned Parenthood a bit. This is a big deal.
Executive order.
Yeah, this is a big deal. So, what was the executive order specifically? I didn't quite see which it was. I got the gist of it and got and dug in for Title 10. Let's see, what was it? Is it in here? Looking.
If I remember correctly from summary, what this does is protects Planned Parenthood's funding. So you cannot go after Planned Parenthood. You can't shut them down. You can't cut their funding.
Yeah. It basically protects Title 10. So Title 10 is the family planning program. From one of the narratives here, since 2011, 13 states have taken action to restrict participation by certain types of providers as subrecipients of Title 10 programs based on factors unrelated to the provider's ability to provide the services under Title 10 effectively. In the last several instances, this has led to disruption of services or reduction of services where the public entity, such as a state health department, holds a Title 10 grant and makes 21 subawards to subrecipients for the provision of services. In response to these actions, this proposed rule requires that any Title 10 recipient subawarding funds for the provision of Title 10 services not prohibit a potential subrecipient from participating for reasons unrelated to its ability to provide services effectively. That was a lot of words, but better than some of the other legalese that we've just been through.
Also, again, remember that Obama is a constitutional scholar.
Yeah.
This legalese in particular is to protect it from it being attacked.
Yeah. So Planned Parenthood receives roughly $70 million annually in Title 10 grants for contraceptives, cancer screenings, sexually transmitted infection screening, and of course, none of that can actually be used for abortion services by law. So that's important to note for anybody that's going crazy.
Again,
you know, and also, thinks that that's all they do.
No, why? Planned Parenthood does so much more than just abortions.
Yeah,
it is not your uncle's chicken shack and abortion clinic.
Yeah, abortive services are less than 3% of everything they do.
And the thing is, Planned Parenthood doesn't just services women's health; they also help care for men's sexual health.
Absolutely.
As well as some of the more sensitive cancer screenings for men. This is not just about women's health. This is just health in general. And conservatives are just attacking these programs for really no logical reason.
No. So the too long didn't read. Title 10 guarantees access and funding, and this proposed rule lays the smackdown on anything that tries to get in the way of that. Basically making sure that organizations like Planned Parenthood can't be defunded for their legitimate services that they're receiving grants through Title 10 for. So if they are a Title 10 recipient, things that would, you know, it would have to be something very serious and provable in order to be effective. Otherwise, this rule is going to allow them to keep going.
Good news.
Mm-hmm.
Congress can't really fight against this. Bad news. Whoever takes control of the executive branch can just repeal it with another executive order.
Well, it's a proposed rule, and I believe it has to go through for some approval.
I'm not entirely certain. Because, again, one of the things that with how we had under W was a severe expansion of executive power. And we're still feeling it. Obama's using it to the best of his ability.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's done less than a lot of presidents, so.
In number of executive orders issued, yeah.
Now, it says here that this is a notice of proposed rulemaking.
Okay.
Let me see if I can, there we go. Okay. So it seeks comment on the proposed amendment of Title IX regulations. So basically, Title X already exists.
Yeah.
This is protecting portions of it.
Well, this specifically protects subrecipients of Title X.
Right. Subrecipients that are there to
provide the services.
To provide the services for Title X.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, subcontractors, basically. You know, treating those subcontractors as the primary. The amendment precludes project recipients from using criteria in their selection of subrecipients that are unrelated to the ability to deliver services to program beneficiaries in an effective manner. So, are they capable of performing these services? Yes. Therefore, you have to let them perform these services. Because we're paying them to do that. Don't get in the way of us paying people to do our job. Basically, that's what it comes down to. So, to be considered, comments should be submitted within 30 days of the publication, which was the 7th, if you happen to want to submit something for it. Let's see.
Addresses. No, the department will publish final regulations. So, this is out for commentary, but then can be signed as a full executive order.
In 2015, more than 4 million individuals received services through more than 3,900 Title X-funded health centers.
4 million individuals through only 3,900. That's staggering.
That's a busy program. That is a busy program. So... Title X serves women, men, and adolescents to enable individuals to freely determine the number and spacing of children. By law, services are provided to low-income individuals at no or reduced cost. Services provided through Title X-funded health centers assist in preventing unintended pregnancies and achieving pregnancies that result in positive birth outcomes. These services include contraceptive services, pregnancy testing, counseling, preconception health services, screening and treatment for sexually transmitted diseases, and HIV testing and referral for treatment services to aid with achieving pregnancy, basic infertility services, and screening for cervical and breast cancer. They do a lot of stuff.
It's not just for women.
Yeah. By statute, Title X funds are not available to programs where abortion is a method of family planning. And no federal funds in Title X or any federal program may be expended for abortions except in cases of rape, incest, or where the life of the mother would be endangered.
Good grief.
So that's... And that is specifically about Consolidated Appropriations Act of 2016. The except in cases of rape, incest, and the life of the mother being endangered. So, there's a lot of stuff here. I've linked to the PDF so that you too can follow along at home and mark it up to your heart's content and know the actual details of what Title X and family planning programs are all about. And how it relates to Planned Parenthood, which is just the giant scapegoat. But this is what's behind Planned Parenthood. This is what allows them to function.
Yeah.
As a government wing, by the way.
Yeah.
So
dive deep, educate yourself, know your law.
Yeah. This is a legal heavy show today, but But man, juicy bits, and a lot of really good information. So, but let's move on, not real far, but over to North Carolina.
Oh yeah.
So it's getting to be basketball season, isn't it?
Basketball is gonna be coming around the corner soon.
Yeah, I mean I know we just got into football. Yeah, we just got into football.
But basketball is gonna be cropping up here in a month.
That's right. So the NCAA, what is it? The National Collegiate Athletics Association.
I believe you nailed it in one.
Alrighty, I'm gonna get myself a cookie. go sports ball. Okay. So they announced Monday the relocation of 7 previously awarded championship events, including the NCAA tournament games in Greensboro, the state North Carolina, during the 2016-2017 academic year as a result of the state's controversial House Bill 2, HB 2, known as Hate Bill 2.
Oh, yeah.
This is desserts. This is so wonderful.
The beautiful thing about this, not just, the NCAA going, hi, we have to pull these because by our charter, we must be inclusive. We cannot discriminate against the student body. We can't. It's in the charter.
That's so wonderful.
So we are forced by our own laws to not be here.
Yeah, and that's even if they agreed with them on a personal level.
Yeah.
Their charter says that they can't.
The fun thing about the USA Today article.
Yep.
Is it gives us, down towards the bottom, the North Carolina response.
Ah, statement. NCGOP reaction to the NCAA.
You can taste the tinfoil.
Would you like to read it or shall I?
Go for it.
Let me get in my announcer voice. All right. Statement. NCGOP reaction to NCAA. Raleigh, North Carolina. This is so absurd, it's almost comical. I genuinely look forward to the NCAA merging all men's and women's teams together as singular, unified, unisex teams. Under the NCAA's logic, colleges should make cheerleaders and football players share bathrooms, showers, and hotel rooms. This decision is an assault to female athletes across the nation. If you are unwilling to have women's bathrooms and locker rooms, how do you have a women's team? I wish the NCAA was this concerned about the women who were raped at Baylor. Perhaps the NCAA should stop with their political peacocking and instead focus their energies on making sure our nation's collegiate athletes are safe, both on and off the field. Kemi Mueller, spokeswoman, NCGOP.
Yeah.
That's not bad for a cold reading.
But
oh my gosh.
You can taste the tinfoil.
It's so bad. It's so bad. I mean, it, and that is bad enough that it's like that's completely unprofessional as a response. The NCAA was very professional in their handling of the entire entire issue. And Andrew Carter, I guess he is a news agent of some merit. As he's a verified Twitter account, he said, here's the NCGOP's response to the NCAA. I made sure it was not a parody account. Because, yeah, you kind of have to.
Oh, no. When this article came out, and when the ruling came down, I was able to tune into ESPN. And they were covering this. And so they had to read that statement and put it up on screen. So everyone across the United States and parts of the globe saw this.
Who is this Kemi Mueller person? Let's give her
a
quick Google.
I have no clue, but they're a special snowflake. Oh, look, it's a white blonde.
Oh, wow. Come on. Yeah, that's her.
It looks like she wants to be the next Fox News host.
Anti-LGBT activist. Wow. No, that's not her.
That's not her, but that's her. Yeah. She looks like she wants to be an anchor on Fox News. Get harassed by Roger Ailes.
Obama assault on civil society. Nice. Oh my God, look. In the background, thank you for HB2.
Look at all those white people.
Oh, wow.
It's a sea of white.
And
it's like
old.
You took white out to the screen.
And their hair.
They're almost all blondes.
Yeah, this is definitely her.
I'm going... I have to go with what Olbermann said in his recent GQ, the closer thing. Well, at least they're not all wearing the same color shirt.
Oh, an error occurred. It does not want to show me the video that that's from.
It feels bad.
Yeah, it does.
YouTube feels bad.
Yeah, it's like, no, we're not gonna do that to you. Yeah, so here we have quite the piece of work. Keep women safe. Keep kids safe.
It's about the children.
Think of the children. Oh, think of the children. Yeah. Interesting. Well, she's definitely got a mouth on her. So.
That was NCGOP rebuttal. And you know, news agencies are going.
Really?
This is serious?
So the seven events that will be relocated. Division I's women's soccer championship. Soccer, not just basketball. So let me get that out of my head. Okay.
So
we got women's soccer.
Div 3, men's and women's soccer.
Men's basketball.
Basketball, first and second rounds. Div 1, women's golf. Div 3, men's and women's tennis. Div 1, women's lacrosse, which is actually a big deal.
Yeah, apparently.
And Div 2, baseball.
New locations for the championship events are expected soon.
They will figure it out.
The NCAA Board of Governors stressed in its announcement that, quote, North Carolina has the only statewide law that makes it unlawful to use a restroom different from the gender of one's birth certificate, regardless of gender identity. Thank you, Associated Press and USA Today, for the joy that you've shown us. Now, before we get into that, I put that one last for a reason. So we're going to go right back up to France is getting rid of plastic disposable dinnerware.
Yeah.
Well, you found this one, so let's dig into it. What is that about?
It's just that. France is taking serious its environmental impact.
Huh.
Single-use cups, plates, knives, and forks are to be banned throughout the country in a bid to reduce plastic production and pollution from waste.
Huh. I wonder if this website is in French. Oh, it's not. Okay, or at least it's not for me, at least. That's good, because my French is so rusty. France passed the controversial law, felt by most those who love to picnic or party. soon, okay, yeah. By 2020, producers of disposable plates, cups, and cutlery must make sure they are made of biologically sourced material and can be composted.
Now, the interesting thing to note, there are companies in India who are making
edible spoons. Yeah.
Edible spoons. Not just that, but also there's development from not just India, but also Japan in making compostable or edible wrappers.
Yeah, Japan's done that for many years, but I think it was just kind of incidental that they did.
Yeah, but no. Yeah. even more so in getting better organic, yet it acts almost in the same way as plastics until you break a seal, which causes a chemical reaction. But yes, Pack to Go, a Brussels-based European convenience packaging manufacturing organization, accused the French government of violating European Union laws on the free movement of goods by passing this law.
That's amazing.
So, Pactigo's Secretary General said, "We are urging the European Commission to do the right thing and take legal action against France for infringing upon European law. If they don't, we will." Now, this threat has very little teeth.
Yeah, what are they going to be able to do? I mean,
because the Commission's going to go, this is in keeping with the Paris Accords. We can't really go against that. Since, well, you know, France, Paris is in France. The Accords are signed there. France has signed on to that. That's a globally binding treaty.
Yeah. The French Environment Minister is yet to respond to Pactigo's comments, but the ban looks set to go ahead as part of France's continued efforts to reduce waste sent to landfills by 50% by 2025. The country has also introduced laws requiring supermarkets to donate unsold food to charity in February and ban single-use plastic bags in July.
Yeah. They're serious about fulfilling their goals.
Well, back here, let's see, the measure formed part of the country's energy transition for green growth bill in 2015 and came in effect last month, but it won't be formally adopted until 2020, giving manufacturers time to ensure the future disposable products are made from biologically sourced material as well as being compostable. According to the local $4.73 billion, that's B, billion, plastic cups are currently thrown away in France. Just in France. Every year, with a whopping 1% being recycled. Wow, I thought we were bad here in the States. Though, I haven't seen those numbers, and it's probably just as bad.
So, they're passing law to uphold the Paris Accords.
Yeah.
They're serious about it.
Yeah, they're walking the walk, talking the talk.
They're attacking this, and, well, private industry is not happy.
Of course not. Why would they be?
Regulation.
Yeah.
But the thing is, the technologies are being developed to fulfill what they're asking. It's just, are the companies going to take some of their earnings and invest in that technology, or are they just going to go throw their hands up in the air and go, well, we're just going to let ourselves be bought out. The executives will get a nice payday. And screw our you know, employees.
I had to follow the other link here. Hamburg, Germany just became the world's first city to ban the coffee pot. K-cups.
Oh, yeah.
Keurig K-cups, or, you know, various other things. K-cup or Nespresso, which was another variety. Yeah, they aren't environmentally friendly. Not one little bit. Thanks to a mix of component parts made from different materials, organic or not, you can't even recycle them properly, and most end up in the dump.
That's why in my household, we have the reusable ones. You just grind your coffee fresh, you put it in there, you wash it out afterwards, we have the filter. Yep. Fantastic.
I bought a bun. I have a nice, big, industrial coffee maker that will make me coffee in 3 minutes. A full pot. That's all I need.
Well, I like having my little individual cups of coffee, or being able to, because we got a big Keurig, the pot.
Mm-hmm.
But we also found with having the filters, both the large one and the little one, that you can also use them to quick brew tea. So I can have a nice quick pot tea, or a quick cup of tea, done. All you have to do is afterwards, you let it cool down, pop, rinse it out, it's good to go again. And it's, while it feels prohibitively expensive to buy one of those, because the first little filter, that's $40, and the big ones, I think $50 or $60.
Yeah.
After a couple of months, it pays for itself because you're not having to go through all those K-Cups, which are far more expensive.
Oh yeah.
Than buying a bag of coffee, or going and buying some tea.
Mm-hmm. That's the other reason why I went with the bun, because it's like, nah, I'm going to have my own cups. It doesn't matter. And anyone that knows me knows that I can drink me some coffee. So I'd be going through an awful lot of K-Cups, and I kind of did the math, and it's like, no, that's prohibitively expensive.
That's, oh, yeah. It's almost like having a Starbucks habit.
Yeah. Oh, it is. It absolutely is. But that's bringing the Starbucks into your own home, which, though for the taste sounds really good, for the price is not. It's not good at all. So at home, you want to be trying to save some money. And
also the price to the environment as well.
Yeah. So because of this, the German city of Hamburg had enough, and in an effort to lead by green example and fight waste, the city banned coffee pods from government buildings. So that's not, of course, across everybody, but at least, again, this is a statement by the government that is not something we want to do. We are going to lead by example.
Good on them.
Yep. According to The Atlantic, 1 in 8 coffees sold in Germany is a prepacked pod.
Wow.
That's considerable.
Yeah, but the thing to understand is, with German culture, it's all about efficiency.
6 grams of coffee in 3 grams of packaging. That is terrible.
Yeah.
Wow. So, yeah.
Ian Hamburg thought that these shouldn't be bought with taxpayers' money.
Absolutely.
Good on them.
Yeah, yeah. The city will make the taxpayer money go a lot further by switching from pods, given the tiny amount of coffee in each prepackaged serving. A pound of pod coffee ends up costing about $40.
Jeez.
Wow. Not even the bougiest roast at your local hipster coffee shop will run you close to that. Which is very true, yeah. So, again, you know, get that nice bun coffee maker, and then you get, you know, a big insulated thermal pot, so it's not cooking it all the time. It just stays at temperature. That's how all the gas stations are doing it now, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even your typical 7-Eleven, you're not going to find the bun with the glass carafe, you know, sitting on the burner just, you know, cooking that coffee constantly. You're going to find now most of them are switching over to the insulated big containers, dispensers. I don't know. What's a good word for those? Any of those. So, good on them. And, you know, maybe you should consider yourself, folks, to be a little bit more eco-friendly with your consumption habits. And now, let's see, basic income, a UK possibility.
Yes, the head of labor over in the UK, Jeremy Corbyn, is interested in doing a study on universal income for the UK. We've seen a number of European nations considering doing universal income. There are a number of studies on universal income ongoing or have just recently been completed. One of the things that they have been finding, which I totally agree with, is it streamlines bureaucracy and it helps in people pursuing jobs that they are best qualified for, though not necessarily having the amount of pay necessary to support their lifestyle.
Well, are we talking lifestyle, or are we just talking being able to actually eat?
More the latter than the former.
Yeah. But yeah, I see buzzwords, you know, which seeks to tackle inequality.
Yeah. Well, think about this. Again, universal income. Mm-hmm. What does this do? Okay. Hi. You know that entire concept, which we'll get to later in Trump's tax plan, where he's going to pay for a lot of the things that he's proposing by cutting down on welfare fraud.
Which doesn't exist, therefore, yeah.
This gets rid of welfare fraud entirely by just making it a flat thing that everybody possesses. You cannot defraud the government when everyone is getting it.
Yeah.
Surprise! You don't have to test for things. You're not spending government money unnecessarily to crack down on fraud when it can't exist. Also, think of it this way, and this wonderful spin to conservative governments, even though the Tories are already tearing out their hair at the very concept, as well as conservatives in many of these nations, going, hey, if we do this, we no longer have to pay for programs. Those go by the wayside because it's all being taken care of through here. Finland was really interested in it because they wouldn't have to worry about their crumbling bureaucracy within their social security structure, because it would just be a flat thing that all citizens get. We wouldn't have to track them individually and based upon their tax history. It is a flat fee adjusted for inflation. Done.
Yeah, a simplification.
Great simplification of social service. And everybody gets it, so you don't have to worry about fraud. Also,
yeah,
by giving them this allowance, yeah, tax rates would rise, but at the same time, there would be a less worry about distribution of wealth. So your bottom, which is supporting your economy globally now, because we're so freaking interconnected, the bottom, which is spending all the money,
yeah,
you would be actually putting a safety net on your economy, because that much money would be in circulation.
I'm looking right now at, I'm looking for the pound to dollar conversion rate. So one British pound currently equals, what do you think it equals?
Roughly $5? How off am I?
You're way off.
Okay.
You're way off, dude. $1.30.
It's dropped since I
It's not done well. It has not done very well.
Well, no. Last time I was over there, last time I was actually using British pounds when I was in London.
Oh, it was like $4 or $5.
No, it was 4.37 to one U.S. dollar.
Yeah.
But that was back in, I want to say 98. So yeah, it's been a couple of decades.
Yeah, so there it is. You can see that it's...
It tanked.
Yeah, pretty considerably. But, you know, it hasn't been way up there in a long time.
It hasn't been up there.
It was only like like 170. Okay. And that was late 2014, early 2015.
Okay.
But it has steadily lost value. It's really slipped. So, okay, so $1.30. That is our conversion here. Now, back to this. A tax-free personal allowance currently worth £11,000 would be abolished, and tax rates would rise, but every adult would receive a payment of £71 a week, or £51 for pensioners, and £59 for children. The authors claim that such a system would cut child poverty by 45%, and that 60% of those in the bottom fifth of the current income distribution would gain more than 20%. So, that's interesting. Okay, so, trying to figure this out here. So, okay, so for children, well, 11,000. That's times $1.30. That's $14,000.
Yeah.
$14,300. So a, let's just look at adults. So 71 pounds times. And I'm getting to a point here. We need to know about this just to understand as we move forward, actually. So that's, it's under $100 a week. That's not a lot.
Yeah, but 52 weeks.
Okay. Times 52. That's $4,800. $4,800 a year.
But without having to cost for social services. It's just something that happens.
Now,
that's not a lot of money.
That is not a lot of money, though. I think that in cases like this, where we're talking about, you know, possible like flat taxes, just as a as another alternative kind of thing, they unfairly hit those that are in the lower percentage brackets, yeah. Very unfairly.
That's why we have a sliding scale.
Yeah, well, that's why we have a sliding scale. Yeah, but you know, if you're starting to do this kind of thing, and then in order to pay for it, you have to then raise taxes and remove some other allowance. You know, I don't think the ends meet as well as they think they do on paper. Because the people that are directly affected, $20 can sink your entire budget.
Yeah.
And in this... Okay, you're going to get enough for groceries.
But how are you going to pay for the roof over your head?
Exactly. You're not going to have any place to put the cans of the beanie weenies and, you know, all those things. So if you had this kind of thing, and you also had the ability to have basic tenement housing, then you're getting somewhere. But I don't think that they're not there yet. This is an interesting idea. And that's why we're going to move on to bad ideas.
Bad idea.
Because down here, just working right in it, there was another another article just before you brought that one up. Because I wanted to talk about this because we have talked about the basic income before. About basic income, a sellout of the American dream. Of course, we're talking here as Americans, but we're talking about, you know, the global stage and how all these things work. Would this ever come to the United States? Certain cities and states are probably looking at it more closely than others.
Seeing that this is coming out of MIT,
yeah,
I want to preface before we even get in here. MIT... And most people from there.
Mm-hmm. That'd be the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, for those that are curious.
Most of their economists, folks, subscribe to the Chicago School of Economics, which is Republican supply side. And as it has been proven multiple times on this show and multiple times in history, supply side economics does not work.
Well, I did not get a chance to read this yet, so I'm skimming through here to try and find any anything that actually has some merit one way or the other, or at least a key talking point. So they do talk about Finland studying a plan to give some 100,000 citizens nearly $1,000 a month as an experiment. Now, $1,000 a month, how much did we say? That Britain was considering?
$4,000 a year, roughly.
Well, $4,800 a year, yeah.
Yeah.
So let me divide that back out by 52. So less than 100 a week.
Yeah. These guys were proposing $1,000 a month.
$370 a month. So Finland is proposing twice that plus.
Yeah.
Okay. you know, $1,000 a month, I could see that. And again, you might actually be able to find housing. You probably wouldn't be able to pay for any, you know, like, bills, other bills, power, for instance, yeah. You know, things of that nature.
Well, considering yeah. just in the rental market around here.
Oh, do we really need to even look at that's, yeah.
Well, in rural areas, it's about anywhere between very low end would be 400 upwards to
yeah.
1200.
You might and be able to rent somebody's room for 300 or something like that, you know, so being super charitable, you yeah. know, you're renting somebody's spare room for 300 and they're being nice enough to include utilities.
Yeah. But that's insanely low. No, yeah. I'm going like 400 to 1200. And that's just rural. Yeah.
Now, also, I want to just point out for those of you following along at home and shaking your head and saying that's too low or you know, what about the children? You know, think of the children. I'm looking at a single individual because yeah. mostly because the math is easier. They did have more money for children, but it was not much more. And kids eat a lot, too, and kids are expensive.
Yeah, kids are not cheap.
You know, you can chintz by on a lot of ramen by yourself. Kids aren't going to eat ramen all the time. I mean, obviously, they'll eat whatever you give them because they have to. But, you know, at some point, life is going to be not worth living. So, okay. So, with Finland, $1,000 a month as an experiment, and four cities in the Netherlands are about to start a trial program as well. Canadian province of Ontario is preparing to run a trial, too. And a national test is under consideration. France's parliament is discussing the topic with some encouragement from the country's finance minister. That's interesting. Meanwhile, Switzerland has come closest to instituting a national basic income. In June, it held a referendum on giving its residents about $2,500 a month. It failed. Only 23% of the voters were in favor.
Now,
note that money it kept going up. It kept creeping up here.
If I may.
Absolutely.
One of the things with basic income is it's supplementary income to whatever it is that you do for a living.
Right. But we're also, you know, if we take it to extremes.
Okay.
You know, because it is supposed to help out those that are of the least fortunate, right?
Yeah.
So what Britain is proposing, that's not going to cut it. That's not going to cut it at all.
Finland would probably have some alleviation. You could cut down certain social services. You'd yeah. still want stuff like job placement.
Yeah.
And work programs. But a lot of your SNAP sort of stuff here,
mm-hmm.
you could do away with the $1,000 a month currently. I'd just like to see any universal basic income have it written into law that it automatically adjusts yearly per inflation.
Right, yeah. Because otherwise people get left behind and then it's a worthless program.
Yeah.
Basically, it fails and it's designed to fail
yeah.
at that point. So, now, I'd say that Switzerland's definitely the closest to coming up with a workable number.
Yeah.
Again, I'm just looking at, you know, what it cost of living, just basic cost of living. Of course, I do not live in Switzerland, so if you happen to know exactly how much it costs to live in Switzerland, please send us an email. But in the meantime, that number seems appropriate. But again, only 23% of the voters were in favor of it, probably because it was going to raise something else to a higher degree than they wanted.
Already high tax rate.
Yeah.
It was going to raise. And let's face it, they have a stronger middle class, so the middle class doesn't like paying more taxes.
Nobody likes paying more taxes, really.
Well, Netherlands don't mind it so much, but they get so many social services, it's ridiculous.
Right, well, if you market it as such, that it's not that you're paying taxes, you're paying for all the government services instead, then you get a better, clearer head about the whole thing, and really, please, you know, if we could get behind something like that, Like, you're not paying taxes. You're paying to make sure that the roads don't fall out from underneath you.
Well,
you know,
like, there you're paying for, we are mandating by government law that you have a month's worth of paid vacation. We're mandating that you have a year's worth of paternity leave, whether you're male or female. We're also putting in place that, if you're sick, you get to go to the doctor. You don't have to worry about paying for it. We pay them.
Yeah.
Now, you're already paying for that.
As you were mentioning that, you know, MIT was probably more of a conservative bent, you're correct, at least with this, because the next one is, let's talk about progressives. Progressives generally like such schemes as long as they don't leave the poor and jobless with less money than they get under existing safety net programs. Many conservatives and libertarians are fans too, thanks in part to the idea that a basic income would shrink government bureaucracy. The Swiss proposal, however, drew opposition from many conservatives, in part because it was intended to be added on top of existing programs.
That's why it did pass.
Yeah. So, in the United States, the basic income concept is gaining renewed interest largely because of a number of leaders in the technology industry are taking it up, especially in Silicon Valley and the San Francisco Bay Area. There's a lot of prominent chatter about basic income right now, says Roy Batt, who heads Bloomberg Beta, a Bloomberg-backed venture capital firm in San Francisco. The chatter got louder after Y Combinator's announcement this year that it will fund and run basic income experiment insofar as so far unnamed U.S. community. The company has also said that a small pilot, not the main experiment, will take place in Oakland as well. Did you know about that?
No, I did not.
I was unaware as well. So
no, I know about a pilot program over in Mumbai.
It sounds like this is becoming something globally popular.
Well,
which is interesting. It's interesting how these things start to rise up and they bloom over here and they bloom over there and all kind of happening at once.
It's easy to get behind when you think about it as high.
Yeah, but has the time come? As they're all popping up, you know, it's like all the plants just know that it's time to bloom.
I don't think it's going to happen yet, though I do think at least one nation will switch to it within our lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
Now, multiple first world nations, I don't think all of them are going to be on it by the end of our lifetimes. But do I think one will? Yes. Do I think maybe more than one? I give that a 60% shot.
I think it would definitely be more than one.
Because
I just don't know how long.
In small, I think it'll actually take hold and stay.
I'm surprised Greece hasn't done this.
Greece can't because it doesn't have the capital yet.
But doesn't that become the problem of how to keep the capital up when you're giving so much of it away?
Well, on the economic side, this actually, universal income, and the reason, one of the many reasons I like this, is it provides your nation's economy with a safety net. Because, again, on the demand side, economics, which is the stuff that works, your lowest earners spend almost all of their money.
Yeah.
They can't save. They have to spend.
Right, and by spending, they keep the economy flowing.
Precisely. It's however much your lowest income earners are spending, how much they're earning, they're immediately spending, that's your basement. That is the foundation of your economy. So the less they're spending, the shakier the economy. The more they're spending, the stronger the foundation.
Which is why when we see that basic minimum wage, when it goes up, the surrounding economy slowly, or in some cases fairly quickly, like with Seattle.
Yeah.
It, you know, went up
it stabilizes, yeah, and it becomes something firm.
Yeah, it stabilizes at a higher level, so there's more fluid cache moving through the system at any given time.
The other positive thing with there's multiple positive things, but the other two things that I want to get across with universal basic income, mm-hmm, is if everybody has it, which is why it should be universal, that's extra income that those that are median wage earners have to save. That is more money they are sitting on. It may not be a significant amount, but your median wage earners save. And those median wage earners are the ones that then later on in life invest in propping up small businesses, which provides, again, for the economy and your community. It's the median wage earners who have saved up that nest egg to pop up whatever dream store they've been wanting to open or dream venture that really help your local economy. It's not the mass economy, but it's the mom and pop places, mm-hmm, that help drive your local economy. So it helps that too.
Yeah.
The other thing that I am totally about spinning here, where universal income, there would be an American version in order for it to get passed, it wouldn't otherwise, is this. Hi, we have universal basic income. Everybody gets it. It's tracked. Did you not spend it? Did you not tax the system? Look, that's your tax credit. It's built in. Your tax credit is built right in. You didn't spend it. You don't get taxed that amount. You save on your taxes the amount that you get from universal basic income. You didn't didn't tap it. Or, oh, look, your car blew up. You had to tap into it. It was just for that month. You didn't spend it for the rest of the year. Okay, that's your tax credit.
Yeah, it's definitely another way to look at it. But, you know, they're going to have to spin it in such an interesting way.
For it to pass here, yeah, because we have people who are enslaved by Chicago-style economics. They're slaves to the idea that the supply side works. It doesn't work. It's never worked. You know what got us out of the Great Depression?
Well, the only time that supply side works, you know, that's the basic theory of supply and demand. You know, if you have an overabundance of supply, then the demand is going to go down. You know, that's the basic stuff, and you probably learned it in your basic high school economics class, because that's where I first, you know, heard about it. It was wrong then too. But you see, the thing is, that works if everybody else is completely thinking the best way. But it does not survive contact with humanity. That's where it fails. Because, again, you know, it presumes that people are going to spend, you know, on things that they need and things like that. But there's a lot of people don't do that, for one. They will hoard the money. And as they do that, they take it out of the economy. It's a much more complex and nuanced system than just a basic supply-side theorem is ever going to get you to. Hence why Keynesian economics, you know, tends to actually play a little bit more towards the reality.
Again, it's you put money in the hands of the people that are going to spend it the most, your economy is going to be more stable. It's going to be more vibrant.
Yeah.
And you can do more.
It's less about the product and more about the money itself and keeping it moving.
You want a fluid economy.
Yeah.
You want the money flowing as opposed to it being consolidated. You want it distributed.
Which is why you want less of those 1%, I've got all the money. The 1% that has more money than all of the bottom 10%.
Because they're not going to spend enough of it. They're not going to spend enough of it to stimulate the economy.
Yeah, they have sequestered that money. It is, for all intents and purposes, out of the economy at that point.
Yeah.
Once it trickles up, which is what almost all money does, once it trickles up into those hands, it never comes back down.
No. Because we don't have a lot of the things that we had in the 50s and 60s.
Mm-hmm.
We had an insane corporate tax rate.
Yeah.
I mean, under Ike, it was 90%. But there was a way around it, a brilliant way around it. It was called reinvestment.
Yeah.
You invested in your own company. You got around that tax.
Which is why the companies flourished. Because it was in their best interest with that tax rate to invest in the company. That's why we have so many enormous companies.
Well, that's why you had, like, with... especially back in the day with car manufacturing.
Yeah.
Why they expanded so much. And it, you had so many manufacturing things. That's why Detroit... that was why Detroit was Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
But once that corporate tax rate fell and we started doing corporate welfare, that's why we're in the state we're in.
Yeah. And it really just comes down to a lot of greed. People want more of it. They're not satisfied with enough. Enough is never enough. I could use that money, but you know what? I have a number that's enough.
Oh yeah.
And then anything past that, that's nice, but I don't need it and I can probably do without it. I don't need a giant house, you know, and that's the thing. Something that is an expendable amount to a middle class person, you know, where if they were building an addition onto their house, they would spend X because it's reasonable to do. As other people in the neighborhood, you know, are also building on, they you would expect that the people in that same kind of status would build similar additions. You know, the price per square foot would be the same. As the wealth increases of the neighborhoods and things like that, of the people around you, then the price per square foot goes up. Because that's how much money they have to spend. It's, you know, it gets complicated, and I'm going off the rails, or, you know, going to get lost in economic theory here. But this article that we were looking at, because it was in MIT Technology Review, what they're looking at is why are you even going to look at the basic income? Well, it's because those jobs are going to go away because of automation and things like that. That's kind of the mythos that surrounds it. So that's the crux of the discussion. And that was also a crux of the discussion with Britain as well. Neil Lawson of Compass, a think tank which has championed the idea of, you know, a basic universal income, said, even if the robots don't come, our labor market is so precarious that as it is, it isn't working, and that's why we need basic income. So, you know, again, they're still thinking, you know, along the lines of why would we even do that, you know, because the jobs are going to go away.
In that's the theory think. That's driving the Mumbai test is that, no, they're looking at the singularity. They're looking at, okay, our cheap labor is only going to have a shelf life for so long. And then what happens when we have automation? What's going to happen to our citizens? This is why we need universal basic income.
Interesting.
because India is already realizing, hey, things are getting out there where our cheap labor is starting to get eaten away in competition. We can't just rely on our massive numbers and cheap cost of living.
Interesting. For here in the United States, they're looking at a $10,000 a year.
That's a bit low.
For every adult.
That's a bit low, in my opinion. If you want to do away with a lot of social services instead of keeping the ones we... I mean, if you're keeping all the social services we already had and doing $10,000, that works. But yeah. If you want to do away, I would suggest... I want to be reasonable and account for emergencies, life expenses. I want to say $25,000.
Yeah. I mean, that's still, I think, the bottom of the barrel where you're... where's the poverty line?
Yeah, that's actually a great question.
Let's see. Federal poverty line, poverty level. Really? That's what you think?
It's incredibly low, isn't it?
That's what you think it is? What do you think it is? Federal poverty level. This is out on healthcare.gov.
Well,
for individuals.
You're already surprised, so I'm guessing it's at 5,000?
No, that's too low.
Too low, okay. 11,000?
$11,880.
That is too low.
That is unrealistically low.
Yeah.
Because, how can you do anything on that?
Well, let's see here. $100 a week for food. Then monthly. 400 for rent. Power, put it at 100. So.
Well, that might be really high if you're just an individual, but, you know.
Yeah, but I'm going by average for the entire year, including summer months. So I'll put it at 100. If you're on public water, that's about 60.
No, so. But dude, you're high. You're high on those. I'd say for all utilities, you. Not including internet, but basic utilities to just live and breathe in the house, you're probably looking at maybe under 150 a month, but right about there.
Okay, 150.
So, yeah.
So, 400, 150, and then about 400 for food a month. So, you're looking at just surviving, not even paying for a car, not paying for internet, not paying for phone.
Yeah.
You're looking at a grand a month. So that's 12,000 a year.
Just barely. Yeah.
And that's no emergencies.
Nope. That's nothing.
No car.
No entertainment.
No phone. No, nothing.
No.
That's just surviving. And that's why I'm looking at, 25K. That won't provide for everything.
Do you want to be really frightened? Or saddened, as it were?
I'm going to be anyway.
Okay. Family of four. What's the poverty line for a family of four?
Family of four.
Yeah.
Well, since you already gave me about 12K for an individual.
Yeah. Yeah, we can route it. We can round it to even thousands.
Yeah. So 12K for an individual.
Yeah.
Family of four. Let's go with the 2,500. Well, 25,000.
24,000.
I was off by 1,000 on my first guess.
24,300 for a family of four. Family of eight.
Okay.
That's the highest it goes, by the way. So
44,000?
40,000. Basically 41,000.
No.
Yes. $40,890 for a family of eight. You want to talk about scraping by? That is scraping by with that many mouths to feed, you know. No. Okay, so that's depressing enough, and this is definitely in the bad news. Let's move along. So, speaking of more bad ideas.
Well, speaking about poor income.
Boy, we're just setting them up and knocking them down here. Oh, dear. U.S. teens often forced to trade sex work for food, study finds. Teens in low-income communities overlooked by childhood nutrition policies do sex work, save school lunches, sell drugs, and join gangs for food. What? Okay. Interesting. Teenagers in America are resorting to sex work because they cannot afford food. The study is out on urban.org, apparently, so you can go find that. Focus groups in all 10 communities analyzed by the Urban Institute, a Washington-based think tank, described girls selling their body or sex for money as a strategy to make ends meet. Boys desperate for food were said to go to extremes such as shoplifting and selling drugs. The findings raised questions over the legacy of Bill Clinton's landmark welfare reform legislation 20 years ago, as well as the spending priorities of Congress and the impact of slow wage growth. Evidence of teenage girls turning to transactional dating with older men is likely to cause particular alarm.
And
transactional dating. I believe that transactional dating is going to have to be part of the show title.
The one of the things I can say from just being a citizen of Netlandia is I've seen a lot of reports and studies about college girls who are on scholarship, pretty much trying to find sugar daddies just to get through college.
Well, college is really freaking expensive. I think I would need a sugar daddy if I went back. So, problem is finding the sugar daddies. there aren't that many of them anymore.
If you're going to some place like Columbia or any, I mean, help NYU, you're in a high earner community in the metropolis, so they're easier to find.
Yeah.
I mean, also UCLA. A lot of your collegiate communities have, you know, sugar daddies in waiting because they're the boosters. They're the guys with the money. Yeah. They're just looking for a pretty young thing to, you know, spoil.
Okay, Susan Popkin, a senior fellow at the Urban Institute and lead author of the report. The report's name is Impossible Choices, by the way. She says, even for me, who has been paying attention to this and has heard women tell their stories for a long time, the extent to which we were hearing about food being related to this vulnerability was new and shocking to me, and the level of desperation that it implies was really shocking. It's a situation I think is just getting worse over time. Because... yeah, they're not trying to go to school, dude. They're trying to feed themselves or their families.
This is a study on teens. Yeah. Not college students. That's an entirely separate article. This is on teens.
Yeah.
And the thing that bothers me is this is on The Guardian. The Guardian is primarily a UK publication, while they have a US entity, a US branch.
Yeah. Which is where this is, yeah.
Yeah, The Guardian is not something that is followed by individuals here in the States.
Of you fine folks that are listening to the ORLY Radio podcast.
So this is something that is not getting traction here, and it desperately needs to.
Yeah.
The qualitative study, carried out in partnership with the food banks network Feeding America, created two focus groups, one male, one female, in each of the 10 poor communities across the U.S. Of course, these are the sample sets that they have. The locations, including big cities such as Chicago, Los Angeles, and Washington, and rural North Carolina and eastern Oregon. A total of 193 participants aged 13 to 18 took part and were allowed to remain anonymous. Their testimony paints a picture of teenagers, often overlooked by policymakers, focused on children aged 0 to 5, missing meals, making sacrifices, and going hungry, with worrying long-term consequences. Popkin said, "We heard the same story everywhere. A really disturbing picture about hunger and food insecurity affecting the well-being of some of the most vulnerable young people. The fact that we heard it everywhere from kids in the same way tells us there's a problem out there that we should be paying attention to." So, from Chicago, Los Angeles, Washington, and even rural North Carolina, and eastern Oregon, there are teenagers going hungry and are vulnerable enough to commit crimes and violate their own persons to eat.
The next sentence, and it's just a sentence, is singular and heartbreaking.
The consistency of the findings across gender, race, and geography was a surprise. Quote, "I wasn't sure we would see it," Bobkin said. "Kids knew about all these strategies. Hanging around your friend's house and see if they'll feed you. Going hungry so that their younger brothers and sisters could eat. Saving their school lunch so they could eat it at night. So they could sleep at night. Everybody knew where you get the cheapest food and how you keep some emergency stuff in your house. It was just very matter-of-fact and very common in the richest country in the world." Wow. Wow. I mean, we're always talking, you know, and in the popular culture, we're always talking about people starving in the third world. But we've got kids starving here, in the first world, probably a block over from you. Yeah. How is that even happening? I mean, we've got, as long as they're in school, and I know this is one of those things because I've heard it many a time, they have free breakfast for anybody. That's just, at least in my county, breakfast is free. If you show up, you eat. They have some free and reduced school lunches. All your parent or guardian has to do is fill out the right paperwork and you've got it. You go through the line, you get food. Those are guarantees by the school, by the state, you know, the county and the state. That might be the only meal that the kids get. And that's, you know, saying here, saving their school lunch so they could eat it at night. So they get two meals a day. They might get breakfast if they get there early enough. And then they might nibble a little bit on their lunch if they're super starving. Otherwise, they're taking it home so that they don't have to go to bed on an empty stomach.
And depending on the county, the quality of the school lunch. In some places,
they don't care about quality. They're caring about quantity at this point. You know, I mean,
no, I'm actually talking about the nutritional value of the school.
Yeah,
lunch.
I know that they're, but the kids that are hungry, they
kids
don't care.
Care.
They don't care about that. Yeah. In every community and in 13 of the 20 focus groups, there were accounts of sexual exploitation often related with distaste. A girl in Portland, Oregon told researchers, quote, "It's really like selling yourself. Like you'll do whatever you need to do to get money or eat." another comment from Portland. You're not even dating. They'll be like, I don't really love him, but I'm going to do what I have to do. When you're selling your body, it's more in disguise. Like if I had sex with you, you have to buy me dinner tonight. That's how girls deal with the struggle. That's better than taking money, because if they take money, they'll be labeled a prostitute. That's a boy in rural North Carolina saying that, by the way. Wow. This is super depressing, dude.
Yeah, but need to be brought up.
Other key findings in the report include, these are bulleted lists, so we'll just go through those and then we'll move on this on from this, I promise, guys. Teens feel a sense of shame around hunger and hide it. Many refuse to accept food or assistance in public settings or from people outside a trusted circle of friends and family. Next, food insecurity. Insecure teens think about how to mitigate their hunger and make food last longer for the whole family. They go to friends' or relatives' houses to eat and save their school lunch for the weekend. For the weekend, even. Parents try to protect teens from hunger and from bearing responsibility for providing for themselves or others. However, teens routinely take on this role, going hungry so younger siblings can eat, or finding ways to bring in food and money. Teens would overwhelmingly prefer to earn money through a formal job, but prospects for youth employment are extremely limited. I'm going to say that again for those of you in the back. Teens would overwhelmingly prefer to earn money through a formal job, but prospects for youth employment are extremely limited. You know why? Because a lot of those minimum wage entry-level jobs are still being taken by adults that need the money, too.
They're being taken by people who have Greece.
Yeah. In a few communities, last bullet point here, teens talked about going to jail or failing school as strategies for ensuring regular meals. That's, I'm going to go to jail because they'll feed me. You know, just recently we had a transgender woman that robbed a bank, threw up all the money so that they would take her back to jail because it was safer there. I mean, people say, you know, with the whole Trump culture and everything that we've got going on, that, you know, they don't feel safe anymore. That, you know, make America great again and all that. This is not what they're focused on.
No.
This doesn't enter into the narrative at all. This is where America needs to be great again. This right here. Not in, you know, whatever misogynistic rant and things like that they want to do and take America back to the 1950s again.
How is immigration hurting us here?
Well, I believe the narrative, as they've portrayed it, would be that they're stealing the jobs. And, you know, if the immigrants weren't stealing the jobs, then the teens who overwhelmingly want to earn money through a formal job could, because the job would be available, magically.
Okay. I just want all of our listeners out there, though most of you are already in the choir. I'm not having to convert you.
Most likely, yeah.
But for your, that uncle, because we all have them.
Yeah.
Or that or that coworker or that friend.
That guy. Yeah.
That guy. Have him go to a sit-down restaurant, fast food joint, the local places. You know. How many of those people are white, black? How many of those people are Mexican? Really, really sit down and assess that. How many of them are young? You know, younger than college age? How many? How many of them are actually, you know, as I see in my local stores, 30, 40 somethings?
Yeah.
People with degrees. People who are trying to earn enough money to feed their family. Some people who are ex-military, and this is the only job they could get. Okay?
You know what? You have fantastic points there. I think that 3, 4, and 6, I think we'll have to put off to next week.
Okay.
But since we're talking about money and taxes and all that gory stuff, let's talk about Donald Trump's tax plan here. Donald Trump wants you to think he's a populist, but his economic plan is built for the rich.
Economics, folks.
Yeah, so, I mean, we're definitely talking about money and following the money and everything that has to do with it. So there was one particularly funny and telling moment during the big speech on economics that Donald Trump delivered Thursday in New York after a long introduction that revisited many of his familiar themes about the evils of globalism, disappearing manufacturing jobs, and the need to put America first. The Republican nominee offered an ambitious mission statement to the crowd of associated business types. His administration, Trump said, would set, quote, a national goal of reaching 4% economic growth. Not a measly 2%, not a measly 3%, but 4%. Quote, my great economists don't want me to say this, but I think we can do better than that, he added as an aside. If the idea of 4% growth sounds familiar to you, that's because Trump isn't the first candidate to bring this up this election cycle. Poor deflated Jeb Bush made the exact same promise when he launched his own presidential campaign, which Trump torpedoed with a steady barrage of mockery. But Trump hasn't just learned to repeat the Republican donor class
shibboleths
about economics. Despite his campaign's populist veneer, Trump is offering this establishment breed of Republican the kinds of policies it most dearly wants, which is to say the platform of massive tax cuts and deregulation that would greatly benefit the sorts of people who can afford to attend the Hamptons fundraiser. Well, yeah. Consider Trump's new tax plan. Well, there's a link. Let's go to the link here.
It's on the Trump Pence site.
Let's see. Tax law changes to make America great again. Anytime I say that, I throw up a little bit in my mouth. Okay, so the Donald Trump plan will revise and update both the individual and corporate tax codes. Okay, individual income tax rates, the Trump plan will collapse the current 7 tax brackets into 3. The rates and breakpoints are as shown below. The tax brackets are similar to those in the House GOP tax blueprint, which I believe was manufactured by Paul Ryan.
Yes.
Which I believe an article said something about by 2025 would show that the tax breaks were only for, that they were for 96% of them or something, were all for the most wealthy.
Well, yes.
Yeah.
Let's just look at the tax rate.
Okay, brackets and rates for married joint filers, brackets for single filers are half of these amounts. Half. Okay. So, taxable income rate. Less than 75. Okay, it starts at 75,000.
Yeah.
It starts there.
Less than 75K, 12%. More than 75K, but less than
225,000.
Yep, 25. This is where I vomit.
More than 225,000, 33%.
And just like
and
that,
that's it. That's done.
Tank and commie. How do you pay for anything?
And what about the lower income earners?
Yeah.
Okay, so brackets for single filers are half these amounts. So does that mean that if I'm a single person and make $74,000, do I pay 6%?
No.
Yeah, I didn't
how I'm translating it is if you earn half the amounts, that's the bracket.
That doesn't even make sense, honestly.
Well,
yeah.
No, I don't know. I want it more ratified than,
yeah.
Hey, we're just throwing these numbers and seeing what sticks.
Yeah, are half these amounts. I mean, that doesn't make sense, honestly. It's like, which half? You got two numbers there. The Trump plan will retain the existing capital gains rate structure, maximum rate of 20%. With tax brackets shown above, carried interest will be taxed at ordinary income. The 3.8% Obamacare tax on investment income will be repealed, as will the alternative minimum tax. The Trump plan will increase the standard deduction for joint filers from to $30,000 from $12,600. And the standard deduction for single filers will be up to $15,000. The personal exemptions will be eliminated. What? As will head of household filing status.
Yeah. Which is going to hurt.
A lot.
Well, it'll specifically hurt lower income.
Yeah. In addition, the Trump plan will cap itemized deductions at $200,000 for married joint filers or $100,000 for single filers. Death tax. The Trump plan will repeal the death tax, but capital gains held until death will be subject to tax.
This is the estate tax.
Yeah.
That's what they're referring to as the death tax.
Yeah, with the first
$10 million. Repeal.
First and $10 million to tax-free.
And for our listeners, the estate tax pretty much only affects millionaires.
Yeah. Well, of course, because with the first $10 million tax-free, as under current law, to exempt small businesses and family farms, to prevent abuse contributions of appreciated assets into private charity established by the descendant or descendant's relatives will be disallowed.
So you can't put up a family trust and funnel money through it, or a family charity to funnel money through it and then back into the family. Which has been a common case of fraud.
Yeah.
But no. Those tax rates, the repeal of the estate tax, no increase in or decrease in capital gains. How are you going to pay for anything? How are you going to pay for infrastructure? How are you going to pay for the military? How are you going to pay for National Endowment of the Arts? How are you going to pay for anything?
What arts? Okay. Childcare. I have children. This is important to me. All but the wealthiest Americans will be able to take an above-the-line deduction for children under age 13 that will be capped at state average for age of child and for elder care for a dependent. The exclusion will not be available to taxpayers with total income over $500,000, married joint, or 200. What does that even mean? Above the line deduction?
It means it's a deduction that is above the normal caps. So when it said that you the caps for deductions for like single filing line item deductions,
what the hell,
versus just an exemption, this gets you past those caps.
The child care exclusion would be provided to families who use stay-at-home parents or grandparents, as well as those who use paid caregivers, and would be limited to 4 children per taxpayer. Okay. The elder care exclusion would be capped at $5,000 per year. The cap would increase each year at the rate of inflation. Okay, the Trump plan would offer spending rebates for child care expenses to certain low-income taxpayers. Are we talking low-income taxpayers as being in that under $75,000 a year bracket?
Yeah.
Interesting what the super wealthy consider low-income, isn't it? Oh, wow. Okay.
The rebate would be equal to 7.65%. Of remaining eligible child care expenses. But what is a child care expense? Subject to cap of...
You're sounding far away.
Okay.
There you go.
Well, we'll fix that.
There you go.
The rebate would be 7.65% of remaining eligible child care expense, subject to a cap of half the payroll taxes paid by the taxpayer, based on the lower earning parent of the two earner household. Rebate would be available to married joint filers earnings. Here we go. Rebate would be for those earning $62,400, $31,200 for single taxpayers or less. Limitations on costs eligible for exclusion and the number of beneficiaries would be the same as for the basic exclusion.
You know what? There's no benefit to being married in taxes anymore.
Nope.
It's just half. That's interesting. That's interesting. So there's no financial benefit anymore to
being married. No.
Being married. In Trump land, there's no benefit. Okay. Huh. All taxpayers would be able to establish dependent care savings accounts for the benefit of specific individuals, including unborn children. Unborn children. Total annual contributions to the DCSA are limited to $2,000 per year from all sources. That's not enough. Which include the account owner, parent in this case of a minor, or the person establishing the elder care account, immediate family members of the account owner, and the employer of the account owner.
This is a... Think of it as a 401k for care for your elderly parent or child.
Yeah.
This is where the employer could do a...
You could do a match or something, maybe.
Match.
Yeah.
But you are limited to putting $2,000 in a year.
Why this, though? I mean, there's so many other things that could be done better.
And the government will provide a 50% match on the parental contributions of up to $1,000 a year.
Really?
Yeah. So you are limited to putting $2,000 in. The government will match you up to $1,000.
So, in theory, you could get a total maximum of $3,000 per year.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. No.
No?
Contributions to a DSA are limited to $2,000 per year from all sources.
So, if you put in $1,000, because it's the reading is what the parental contributions.
Yeah.
So, you have to put in $1,000, the government will match $1,000. But if you only put in $500, your employer puts in $500, the government only matches $500.
Right.
Wow, that sucks.
Man, that just, yeah. I hate these accounts, by the way, because you know what? You'll have all that, and then you won't be allowed to use it. Yeah, because that's how these work. Because all this would go through an insurance company, and the insurance company would be the gatekeeper and say, "No, you don't. No, you, that's not an eligible expense." I've been down that road. That's what they do. and of course, any money that is in that account, there's probably a fee to maintain the account, and all sorts of things. A little graft here and there. You know, half cents on the dollar kind of thing. Okay, so that was how they were personally going to screw you. Now let's look at business tax. I bet it's going to be a lot better.
Oh, the Trump plan lowered the business tax rate from 35 to 15% and eliminate the corporate alternative minimum tax.
How are they going to make any money for the government?
They're not. That's the thing. They're going to try and bankrupt the government. Because, remember, Trump already said earlier on in multiple speeches that when it comes to our debts, we're just not going to pay them. We're going to pay less. Oh, we need more money, we're just going to print it.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah. Folks. Okay. Get out, vote, drag everybody you can. And, you know, have these uncomfortable conversations with Trump supporters. Try to, you know, just try to figure out. It's like, okay, so how exactly is he going to pay for all these things? And by the way, dad, mom, sister, brother, how much do you make a year? What tax bracket are you in now? Are you in that 15% tax bracket?
At 12, yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean, like, right now, you know, are you in that, you know? Yeah. Hmm.
And the thing is, it helps the wealthy more than anybody else.
Oh, it does. By far.
33% on your own personal earnings. You don't have to worry about estate tax. Corporate tax is lowered to 15%. So your
That's
business...
20% less for those counting at home.
Yeah. Your business is paying 20% less, which if you... And capital gains is going to be lessened.
Right. Which means then you can give yourself a nice big raise.
Yeah. You can put that raise in and write that off. Mm-hmm. Plus you're getting corporate welfare, because that's not being repealed.
Yeah, no, that's going to go away.
So.
It eliminates most corporate tax expenditures, except for research and development credit. Provide deemed reparation of corporate profits held offshore.
Repatriation.
It will provide a deemed repatriation of corporate profits held offshore at a one-time tax rate of 10%.
So if you have a tax shelter offshore, you're paying 10% of that. But so then, if they catch you...
But then you can bring it all back.
If they catch you, you're paying 10% of what's there.
Yeah.
Which is a drop in the bucket.
Right. And so think of Google and the
Apple.
Apple. Think specifically of Apple in Ireland right now.
Yeah. That was a couple billion.
Yeah.
They pay 10% of that because we caught.
Which would probably be less than the Irish tax that they're going to want to get off of it.
And it would be less than if they actually moved it back here, because it's 10%, not 15.
Yeah.
It's 10%, not 15. If you want to actually have an offshore tax penalty, you make it greater than the 15%. That way it forces them to bring the money back into the country.
Well, no, this would be... This makes it better for them to bring it back, and then it would be here.
So it'd just be the 115% as opposed to getting dinged for 25. But
yeah,
still, if you want to actually be prohibitive, you would have it match or exceed. If you want it to truly really be prohibitive, 20%.
This isn't a penalty, really. This is what this is a benefit. Bring that money home. Make it elsewhere. Make it in that other country, but bring it home. We'll charge you less. They're turning America into the tax haven.
Yeah.
Technically, not a bad idea.
Yeah.
Well, it's repatriation, so it's money for a company that is based in the United States. Yeah. I could see going either way with that one. That's of my least concern about everything in here. Firms engaging in manufacturing in the U.S. may elect to expense capital investment and lose the deduction, the deductibility of corporate interest expense. An election once made can be revoked within the first 3 years of election. If revoked, returns of prior years would need to be amended to show revised status after 3 years. Election is irrevocable. Okay. So you either get the capital investment expense or you reinvest in your own company. I'm guessing by that one. I think so. Annual cap for the business tax credit on for on-site child care authorization by SEC 205 of
tax credit would be increased to $500,000 per year.
Yeah.
So that incentivizes for the biggest corps.
Yeah.
That doesn't do a lot for your mom and pop, which isn't making that much, spending that much on childcare.
Right.
So it's for major corps. That's incentivizing, but that's a minor silver lining in the shitstorm.
Okay, so the Economic Growth and Tax Relief Reconciliation Act of 2001, which would increase to $500,000. Wow, a $350,000 up.
Yeah. It's the Ivanka plan to, you know, have more child care, which is incentivizing only for corporations that would spend that much on child care. What corp is spending $500,000 on child care?
I don't know of any.
So this is how you funnel the money. You want even more tax savings? Here's $500,000. Spend $500,000 on child care.
Mm-hmm. Businesses that pay a portion of an employee's child care expenses can exclude those contributions from income.
What qualifies as child care?
That's a good question. Employees who are recipients of direct employer subsidies would not be able to exclude those costs from the individual income tax, and the costs of direct subsidies to employees could not be used as a cost eligible for the credit. Well, that's just taking money away from the employer, from the employee.
Yeah. Employees are screwed. Corporations are great. Welcome to Trump's America.
It's short and awful. Like his fingers. Okay. That's it. I cannot go on any further. Not in good conscience anyway. Man. They're saying that his original vision released last year was a barely thought-out parody of a public policy document. A monstrous giveaway to the wealthy with a price tag somewhere north of $10 trillion over a decade, or more expensive than Medicare. With some help from some of the old Republican supply side hands, like former Heritage Foundation chief economist Stephen Moore, Trump has scaled back his new blueprint into a more generically bonkers conservative proposal. That's good writing. which is to say that it would still cost a budget-busting $4.4 trillion, with much of the benefits clearly tilted to the wealthy. Trump argued Thursday that his income tax cuts, which also include much-hyped credits for child care, would lower the IRS burden for middle-class families, while some earning $5 million will receive virtually no change in their tax bill at all.
No, they would. They're only paying 33%.
Yeah.
That's a huge, huge cut in taxes.
Well, let's see. Okay. Hello, Google. 2016 tax brackets. Let me just drag this over here. Okay. So, estimated income tax brackets. This is out on taxfoundation.org. So, wait, that doesn't seem right. Let's just go straight to the IRS. How about that? Okay, that's better. That's better. All right. Now we're getting somewhere here. Okay. So, the taxable income tax rate. So, if you're below that poverty line, your tax rate is 10%.
Yeah.
Under Trump's new plan, it's 12%.
Yeah, your taxes got raised.
Your taxes go up. Taxes go up on the absolute lowest percentage people that can't afford any of it.
The people who actually get a benefit are those that are making over $9,000.
Yeah. So up to...
up to 75,000.
Yeah, up to 75,000. So he's cutting one of those brackets a bit. Now he has three. There are currently seven brackets. A 10%, a 15%, a 25%, a 28%, a 33%, a 35%, and a 39.6%.
Yes.
So he is definitely saving people that are silly wealthy. That's
a lot of money.
Yeah, anybody earning right now over $190,000 a year. His what was it? What's his tax breakout? It was 33%. So
over 225.
Whoa! I changed the window shape and the whole website moved. Okay. All right, there we go. Okay, so side by side here. So up to 33%. So, yeah.
Those on the high side of the middle class get a bit of a break. Well, Trump's middle class, I should say.
Oh, wait. That's for married filed jointly. There we go. Slightly different. Still basically the same.
Yeah.
But the cash numbers change. So those... oh, actually, the number of people that are under the 18,550 and, you know, zero to that, it's a 10% tax rate currently for 2016.
You'd be increasing taxes on those people.
Yeah, you'd get another 2% tax hike from that. Then people above that up to 75,000
would be getting a 3% tax cut.
Would be getting a cut, yeah. And then after that, it gets a little funky.
After that, it is people who are making...
From there, he collapsed three different tax brackets into 1.5.
Yeah. Those that are making more than, I want to just round up, $152,000. You are seeing a 3% tax break. Those of you who are making over... pretty much, if you are making over $414,000,
yeah,
you get a 2% tax break. For those of you who are making over $466,000, you are receiving a 3.6 tax break.
6.6.
So the people who are getting the biggest tax break are the biggest earners.
Yes. And that's just wrong. Now, of course, that's married filed jointly. If you're head of household, then your numbers are still a little bit different. But it doesn't matter because he's going to get rid of head of household.
Yep.
Okay. All right. See how it's going. It's fine. Okay, so we did have a couple other things about pipeline spills, poisoning the water in Florida down to the aquifer, and also good cops getting fired and things like that for doing the right thing, refusing to actually shoot somebody. But we're going to address those next time because, you know what? This has just beaten us up. Mentally, yep. I am exhausted from this. It really hard. This last half of the show is really hard, man. So I'm going to go pickless other than I do have one, I guess, at Aldi, which is a German corporate low cost grocery store, which is taking off really big down in the south here. They've got little store brands and things like that. But I found a sriracha ketchup, and it's delicious. So, yeah, sriracha ketchup, that's my pick. Go fig. So, Daniel, you've got Warhammer 40K as an RPG. What's this? What's all this about?
This is with Fantasy Flight.
Okay, yeah, you featured them before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Warhammer 40K, our grim dark future, which is seemingly coming far too soon, they have, well, not for long, Fantasy Flight has a license for the 40K universe, and they've been providing wonderful, delicious RPG books to play in that playground.
Okay.
You've got everything from the Inquisition, that's Dark Heresy. You can play Imp Guard, The Holy War. You can play Rogue Space, Time for Piracy, and other fun things with Rogue Trader. Be a Space Marine with Death Watch. You can be a member of the Chaos Crusade with Black Crusade. And they also have a number of board games, a card game, which is Conquest. All this I bring up now because the license is going away soon, which means all these products will be on sale.
Ooh. Soon.
Probably Black Friday, you're going to be looking at all this stuff will be on super sale because they will no longer have the license.
I see. Okay. So if I was going to pick something up that I've never played this before, what would you recommend?
As a good introduction to the 40K universe and after they've ironed out mechanics issues, I would suggest Rogue Trader out of all those because you get to play Space Profiteers. You get all the wonderful flavor of the 40K universe, but you get a lot of your space travel. interacting with different planets, their resources, their people, running afoul of aliens and heretics and all sorts of interesting things. Also, if you want to actually play as Xenos, the rules for that are in Rogue Trader, unlike the other series. You can actually have a alien on board your ship that's part of your crew.
There's a lot of books in the Rogue Trader series here.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
But, no, the character creation is fun. And the game is mostly balanced, unlike most Fantasy Flight things, which are halfway balanced. So, it's definitely worth a look. It's fun. They have a lot of pre-published campaigns, mm-hmm. so it's easier to run. And again, they have all the details with Rogue Trader of space combat. And who doesn't want to do, you know, your dark gothic space opera without some good old-fashioned space combat?
Build your own starship. Or yep. Begin play with one of six pre-generated vessels. Yeah. So you can find them right now at Fantasy Flight Games. You can follow the link on our show notes. Looking like the core book is about $60, and the other expansions are in the neighborhood of $40. Some of them are less, $25.
These will probably be going on sale. Also, if you're going to your local game shop, they'll probably be a bit cheaper. Or if you're looking for online discount and delivery, I can always suggest Cool Stuff Games online. They are always good for these sort of things. So, but it's fun. If you like 40K, this is a great pairing. And soon there will be a great opportunity to harvest these books before they are out of print.
While Rogue Trader focuses on a different aspect of Warhammer 40K universe, the rule system is compatible with Dark Heresy. If you choose, characters from Dark Heresy can easily be integrated into Rogue Trader campaign or vice versa. The Rogue Trader core rulebook provides all the rules necessary to enjoy a complete role-playing experience in the grim darkness of the far future. See, that's good. That's good. So if you go with the Rogue Trader or with Dark Heresy, then you have two full sets of books that you can you can play with.
You use and play back and forth.
Yeah.
Dark Heresy is more grimdark, and it was the first system, so it has some mechanical clunkiness in that their economy doesn't work.
That's interesting. Well,
they fixed that with the later iterations. Only War, Rogue Trader, Black Crusade, Death Watch. All of those fix the economy problem.
Hmm. Okay, I did see that there was something on economy under Rogue Trader as one of their books, too.
Oh, yeah, there's Faith and Coin.
Faith and Coin, yeah.
Which gets you all the wonderful things about the ecclesiarchy and spreading the imperial creed across the stars.
Oh, goody.
It's religion.
Yeah.
And all of its dark and terrible glory in the grim dark future.
Ah, the grim dark future. We are going to know you well. Okay. You got anything else for us tonight, or are we done?
We done.
Okay. And there we go. Okay. Well, let's see if I can actually go through the new outro script without stumbling too terribly. Okay. So that's it for this show. We'll be back live, so you can join in all the fun in the chat. All from our webpage next Friday, about 9:30 p.m. Eastern. In the meantime, head over to ORLYRADIO.com. That's ORLYRADIO for all the links right at the top for all that we do. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Tumblr, Google Plus for some. I've removed Google Plus actually, but I'm so used to saying it. Google Plus, it looks like they're taking it away. It seems to be falling away by the wayside faster and faster. But anyway, we still have YouTube, and we, of course, have the Twitch channel, which we stream to every week. So subscribe to those, and you'll never miss when we're on. If you're hearing this right now, then you must like us. So if you do, then others may as well. So you can do us a favor and share the show and review us on iTunes, please. Now, if you really love us, you can contribute to the Patreon and get early access to the midweek show releases. That would be like this one. And we'll even get you some special perks now and then when they're available. Just follow the Patreon link on the webpage or go over to patreon.com/ORLYRADIO. You can also make a one-time donation via the donate button, too. I'm not going to stop you from that at all. So we're always looking for new ideas for the show. So how about you share what's on your mind and shoot us a note over to orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com, or if you're the more talkative sort, how about 470-222-6759. It's always ready to take your call or text. We can't thank you enough for spending some time with us. Until next time, this has been O'Reilly Radio, part of the Cowen Services Network. Music for the show was created by Kevin McLeod of incomptech.com. And on behalf of O'Reilly Radio and Daniel Atherton, we bid you adieu. Toodles!